I always hear a lot of guys calling in, and they're always like, you know, down and out about their haircuts.
Sure.
I lost my hair when I was 16 to 17 years old.
That's heavy.
Oh, man, I'm sorry to hear that.
No, it's all good, man. And, you know, the funny thing is that I've learned to overcome it. And I've had a much, like, I'm much more empowered to be myself now.
Well, I admire that.
Oh, no, it's cool. Dude, let me tell you, it took a long time. I want to scream. I want to shout. I want to know what it's all about. Yeah, you know, it really is amazing about all the bad transplants you do see out there. I mean, I was on the train the other day, and I saw three guys in one car.
Yeah.
On the subway. It was horrible. It was a horror show. I mean, they didn't hear you, and that's a problem. That's why you have to guys get out there and get as mainstream as you can. I went to Dr. Bernstein only because of you guys. You know, God forbid I would have went to somebody else like Bosley.
Bottom line, I'm begging anybody out there, before you go and get surgery, before you walk into these hair club system places, I'm telling you right now, I am $20,000 in the hole and 10 years of stress, the last three, an absolutely horrifying existence of stress and pain. And I can promise you, the stress of this hairpiece is 1,000 times more than I would have ever felt if I had just been confident with who I am, dealt with the fact that these are the cards I've been dealt and deal with them and just shave my head. And honestly, like Spencer said, not everyone's there, but that's where I'm at.
Hey guys, welcome to the show. 888-659-3727. Great to be here. Another Tuesday night doing the Bald Show. Welcome everyone who is new to the broadcast, who may just be tuning in for the very first time and thinking to themselves, what is it that I'm watching? What did I just listen to? What was that clip of this guy talking about his hair loss and wearing a hairpiece and having a bad hair transplant? Well, I'll tell you, if you're new to the broadcast, don't know who I am or why I'm here, I'm a consumer advocate for men and women dealing with hair loss. I am the author of The Bald Truth, The Truth About Women's Hair Loss, and I also happen to be the founder of the American Hair Loss Association. And what this broadcast is all about is really we do this every week to try to provide hair loss sufferers who basically make up the largest demographic of all humankind. We try to provide them with a safe place to come and talk about an issue that society just does not allow us to talk about. And if we do talk about it, I mean, especially as men, we're looked at as vain. For whatever reason, it is the last bastion of political incorrectness. We cannot admit that it concerns us, even though our appearance is certainly eroding as our hairline erodes. And people certainly seem to feel comfortable enough to comment on that fact. And we are certainly being related to and looked at in a different manner than we were before we started to lose our hair. But we can't talk about it. We're not allowed to. For whatever reason, it's 2015 and it's still the same shit. So that's why I do this. I provide this platform for all of us to come together every week to talk about this issue that we can't talk about at work, we can't talk about with our friends, we can't talk about with our wives. I mean, some of us can. We can't talk about with our, you know, people at work. But you know what? They're talking about you. Sadly. And, you know, for the women who may be tuning in, and sadly, a lot of women who tune in are hair loss sufferers as well, because 40% of hair loss sufferers are women. But for the women who may be tuning in, who are finding us on the GFQ network, guys from Queens, or through Ustream, or through Daily Motion, or on iTunes Radio, or on Stitcher Radio, or listening to us on iHeart Radio, who are like, what's the big deal? Just shave your head. I want you girls to try to imagine the same process happening to you. Forget about what society thinks of it. Forget about that society accepts guys dealing with hair loss or going bald because we see so many of them around. Think about how it would make you feel if all of a sudden your crown and glory began to diminish. You're no longer able to style your hair the way you want to style your hair. No longer able to wake up in the morning and get into that shower and shampoo and condition your hair and do whatever you want to it. We deal with the same shit. And you know what? If you're watching me for the first time and you're like, wait a second. This guy's not a young guy. He still looks like he's got hair in his head. What's going on? Why is he talking about hair loss? Well, what you're seeing is a partial sham. I have been lucky enough to stop the progression of my hair loss or slow it down for many, many years, for over 2 decades, using an FDA-approved drug, which is Finasteride, or it's now marketed as Propecia since 1998. And I wear a half a can of hairspray and some makeup on the back of my head. And that's how I do. It's what I got to deal with. That's it. You know, for me, it's not a big deal. How I live my life. You know, there are people out there that have to put on a prosthetic leg to get up in the morning. It's not a big deal for me to put a little makeup on my head and admit that I do it. But for a lot of guys, it is a big deal. They don't want to admit that they're doing that, or they don't want to even try it. They're so uncomfortable trying to make themselves feel comfortable in their own skin or admitting that they're trying to make themselves look and feel better that they avoid life. They avoid social situations. They avoid trying to, you know, improve their appearance because of what others may think of them. That is a major issue that I want to talk about tonight. Why do so many guys allow the perception of others or what you think might be the perception of others dictate your lives? If you want to get a hair transplant, go get a hair transplant. Just do your due diligence and know what you're getting into. If you want to wear a hairpiece, and there are some really undetectable hairpieces, why not do it for yourself? Why? Because you see guys being made fun of who are wearing bad hairpieces? You don't have to be one of those guys. If you want to paint your head, you paint your head. We have one life. This is it. This is what we have to live. We cannot live based on our fears of how other people are going to perceive us. 888-659-3727. I know that Joe Tillman is calling in via Skype. I want to make sure that I can pot him up. We can talk about this and some other things, and I'm going to get to the phones in a couple of minutes. I have two Skype lines, so let's see if this is Joe. Joe, is that you? Okay. Joe, is that you?
I am here.
Hey, man.
Hey, how's it going?
I can't complain. Let me make sure I have your levels right. So okay. Let's just talk a little bit. So you listened to my opening.
Yeah.
You're one of those guys who had to kind of adjust on many levels. Not only were you balding at a young age, but you had a really bad hair transplant at a young age.
Twice.
Jesus.
Yeah.
You know, I don't mean to laugh, but it's like it's that's not uncommon. That's what happens. Because you think you go to the bad guy, you go to the guy, you get a bad work done, and somehow you're convinced by the same doctor that he could fix it.
Yeah. And don't get me started. No, I laugh about it because it's my own personal journey, and if you can't laugh at yourself, who can you laugh at? Right?
Yeah.
But with my history, I look back on it and yeah, it was very traumatic for me. And I went through the pain of two very primitive surgeries compared to what you get now. It was very painful. And then the pain of having to deal with it and lose all my hair subsequent to the two procedures. as far as my native hair goes, and, you know, full blown Norwood 5 by the time I was 25, 26 years old, progressing to almost a Norwood 7 by the time I was 31.
Yeah.
But still having a pluggy hairline to remind everyone and myself of the stupid decision I made twice. So,
you know what's unfortunate about that? And you just said a mouthful as far as the stupid decision that you made. It's not like you made a stupid decision. You made a decision based on the recommendation of someone who you thought was a professional, a physician, a guy in a white coat, a guy that took the time that, you know, graduated from university and went to medical school and is now a doctor.
Yeah.
So, I mean, while we try to explain to people the importance of really doing their research, it's not easy.
Well, everyone has to start somewhere, right? And unfortunately, I started at the beginning with the surgery and not the research because, you know, number one, no one told me to research. Number two, there was no internet really to speak of to do the research on. And back then, I mean, you really had to have the resources at your disposal to do proper research. You know, to dig in somehow before we had this thing called the internet. I don't know how people did research back then, but yeah, I mean, it just wasn't available to me. It wasn't a mindset that I was in. I was 22 years old, young and dumb, and, you know, no offense to anyone else that's 22, but
sure.
Yeah, I mean, compared to where I am now, yeah, I was young and dumb. And, you know, it wasn't the first surgery that was a stupid mistake. That was just a natural thing to do. Like you said, you know, the guy in the white coat told me I needed to have it done, talked me into it. I believed him because why wouldn't I? We're trained from birth to believe the men in the white coats. And it was the second one that was the dumb one because it was with the same guy to fix the problem that he caused to begin with. And it comes down to this. That was actually the point of my first intelligent question, but I didn't connect the dots. I said, what happens if I lose more hair? And his answer was, albeit while I was in the chair, was, oh, you won't lose any more hair, and by the time you do, you'll be 50 years old.
Yeah, yeah. And and especially back in the day, that was a very typical response. And you're right, there was nothing out there. You know, when I wrote The Bald Truth, when The Bald Truth was published, actually, in 98, there still was really nothing out there. And it made such a stir in the industry. And, you know, you were talking about white coats. I remember, because of the book and because of the broadcast, in 1999, I was involved in a lawsuit with a New York doctor who we ended up destroying in that situation. Mm-hmm. But I just remember looking at the documents, and there was a quote from me basically saying that butchers were white coats too. And you know, and that was a line that I used a lot. You know, when I came out in when I first started doing what I do, I really came out swinging and just, you know, telling it like it is.
Yeah.
And that was a very important lawsuit for me because after that occurred, it was basically, you know, hands off. You know, I'm out here telling the truth.
Yeah.
You can't try to, you know, to move in that direction. That's actually called slap. But anyway, your story is so typical, and it's typical even today. As much information that there's out there online on the forums. Every day, people are being taken by some newfangled device or some nonsense or some novice who's making claims that they've been, you know, performing these many surgeries and they've done these many grafts. And it's all made up marketing bullshit.
It's not just that, Spencer. It's clinics that are taking existing technology and modifying the words and the descriptives to suit their own means.
Right.
Right. Like when FUE came out. Suddenly, everyone was doing FUE, and we're the inventors of FUE.
Well, I'm going to get in trouble for even saying this again. I'm going to get some crazy email in the middle of the night. What? But you know, the truth is, I mean, that's just the way that it is. Everyone tried to latch onto it. A certain groups, you know, some people just tried to, you know, claim that they were the pioneers.
Yeah.
Some were pioneers, some weren't pioneers, but everyone is kind of, you know, developing their own name for the technique. You know. I have to tell you, I think the Woods technique was a good name because that's what it was. Now, unfortunately, Ray Woods really didn't share it, so I can kind of understand why the name of the technique was changed.
Right. You know, and this, I didn't really mean to kind of zero in on the FU. It was just the first thing that popped in my head. But, you know, it's FUE. It's scalp micropigmentation. It's, you know, even follicular unit grafting.
Oh, yeah. Well, there's FUSS, there's FUT, there's FU, you know, yeah. I mean, it's just, Jesus. Hey,
you know, there's all kinds of FUs, but, yeah. And, but no, it's just, it's typical, you know, instead of actually taking the time to do it right or to learn from the originators or the innovators, people will just take the catchphrases, turn it around, apply it to their own, you know, widget, and, you know, and no one knows any better. And before people do realize, it's not what's claimed. It's too late, and you know it's just the history of the industry overall.
Well, listen, I was recently asked to speak at a conference. I'm not going to give out the name of the conference. I'm not going to say when it is, but it obviously has to do with the hair world. And you know, one of the things that I really want to focus on is exactly what we're talking about now, and just the confusion in the marketplace. And the fact of the matter is that this confusion is actually causing a lot of harm to the industry itself, and those that are causing this confusion don't even realize, and those that are involved in the confusion and that are perpetuating some of the stuff online, they're causing their own practices harm.
Yeah.
And they don't even get it. They think they need to do it in order to compete, but they're actually causing themselves harm, their bottom line, their pocketbooks.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I think sometimes you have to kind of relate in those terms to some of these doctors so that they kind of understand, like, you know what? Telling the truth works. It really does. There's a lot more money to be made in good medicine in the long run than there is in bad medicine or in trying to, you know, falsely market what you're offering.
And that's exactly what I'm, it's funny you mentioned that. I was thinking about, you know, my new path, my new direction, my new website that's still not launched yet. But, you know, the things I'm concerned about and the things that have been on my mind for the past several months, actually, are exactly in line with what you just said, that the truth, you know, for lack of a better, the truth will set you free. The truth will, you know, clinics that are being more transparent, clinics that are being more honest with themselves as well as their clients, are destined in the long term or long run to be, you know, considered at the top of the crop.
Well, right? I'm telling these guys, I'm saying, listen, if you're going to be posting stuff online, post your mediocre cases. Don't be afraid to do that. Post the realistic smaller numbers and some of the mediocre cases, because you have to put that out there for consumers to understand that, you know, not every case is a home run. It's not every case
post
is a 5,000.
Yeah,
exactly. Post different angles, post the top. Don't be afraid to show what the reality is, because in the end, when the patient comes back to you in a year and says, wait a second, I saw these images online, my scalp doesn't look like this, they think something went wrong. As opposed to, this is the natural process. You can have more work done if you'd like, but this is really what it looks like.
It's because of the fear of how they're perceived online that clinics, you know, have been posting these Norwood 6 before pictures, every angle shown, and then a year later you get the hairline and a 3/4 angle shot, and that's it. You don't see the back, and so
a selfie in the guy's car.
Yeah, exactly. And the viewer is left thinking, "Wow, 1,700 grafts covered this guy." This guy's scalp. Man, I want some of that, right?
I know. I try to talk to these guys. You know, we have a couple of guys on the IHS who are posting more modest cases. And I really appreciate that. I'm advising them to do it. And I hope that some of the guys that have been posting all the home runs will start doing it as well, because, you know, a large percentage of their patient population or clientele are more modest cases, even in the best hands. It's got to be put out there, because it's going to make everyone's life, especially the patient's life, so much easier, because so many patients go on sites and, you know the sites that they're going on, and they're out there, they're complaining about something that they really don't need to complain about because they got a reasonable result.
And when people that actually know what should be expected come out and say, hey, this is actually something that is a good thing, that, you know, you actually look good for what you've been through.
Right.
they're looked at as cheerleaders. They're looked
I know.
And it kills me. It's like,
I've
been there, Spencer. I've been on the side that has been, you know, presenting these fantastic results. I mean, you know, world leading results. But one of the things I keep getting is, well, is this every day or is this a one off? And the truth of the matter is the truth is somewhere in between.
Right. They're not listening to the back end. They're not listening to the guys that may be calling these types of clinics up and saying, you know, and they're upset because they believed they were going to get this home run. When they shouldn't be upset, their lives could have been made much easier throughout the entire process if they were just fully informed that, listen, you have this type of hair caliber, you have this, you know, density per square centimeter that can be moved, you have, you know, different characteristics than these images that you're seeing. So this is going to be more like your case, you know, and show them images that are closer to what they can possibly achieve. Too many clinics are afraid to do that. It's a huge mistake, and I'd like to change that. We've got a full board, so why don't we take some calls, and then we can continue on this path.
Yep.
Well, you know, we'll just kind of see what people want to talk about also.
Very cool.
Let's see who this is. Hey, man, you're on the air. Who's this, and where are you calling from?
Hello?
Yes, hi.
Hey, Spencer, this is Chris from Ohio.
Oh.
You got the refund for
it? Hey, man, how are you? Chris,
hey,
I got I got a lot of refunds. Which Chris?
The one you helped me, we just emailed a little while ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
how are you, man?
And Chris?
I'm hanging in there. How about you?
I'm all right, man. So actually, if I remember correctly, I think that it was Joe Tillman that mm-hmm. connected us.
Yes,
initially.
Absolutely. It's kind of ironic he's on the show tonight, yeah.
how you doing,
Joe,
Chris?
Who got me in touch with you.
Can you hear
hey,
him?
Joe, how's it going? No, I can't.
You can't hear him at all. All right, let's see if I could make something happen here. All right, go ahead.
Can you hear me now? Okay. Chris?
Yes.
Hey, there you are. How you doing, buddy?
Hey, I'm good, man. How you doing?
I'm good. I'm glad things worked out for you.
Sort of, I guess.
Sort of.
I mean, as far as the as far as the head pains go, I'm sure you remember our conversations about that.
Yeah, I do.
They're still there. They're not as persistent as they were back when we talked. Back then it was a daily thing. Now it's maybe a couple times a week. Like I still can't sleep on my right side because I'll immediately get the head pains. But I have to, you know, take ibuprofen a couple times a week for the headaches because they get kind of bad sometimes. But other than that, it's been 5 years since the surgery already in June. So.
Yeah.
Oh, time flies, man. Time flies.
It does, for sure.
I'm glad that you're doing better. Now, I'm working on Joe's levels for you. So every once in a while, I'm going to ask if you could hear Joe. And, you know, you just kind of let me know how things sound to you. So, all right, so tell me what's going on.
Well, the reason I emailed you, other than, you know, give you an update on what I've been up to, but I got on the Finasteride about a year ago in November.
I remember, dude, you were like pushing me to give you a direct response as far as whether or not you should take it. And I wouldn't do that. I had to be your choice.
Yeah. It wasn't something I wanted to do. I guess kind of maybe I was looking for a little bit of a push one way or the other as far as, you know, just kind of because I was on the fence big time about it. But
You guys is, you know, my experience on it and the experience of others who have been either involved with the show or have contacted us over the years. Including you. But for me, when someone asks me a direct question, should I take this and how much should I take? I cannot tell you to take a drug. And I just never have felt comfortable with that. So I'm glad that you finally made your decision, you know, on your own, because you know how I feel about it. For me, it's been a very positive experience.
Right. That's what I kept replaying in my head, you know, you saying that, and I figured, well, I've been taking I got the 5-mg pills and I cut those in half, and then I cut those half pieces into thirds, and I take one small piece twice a week. I've been doing that since last November. I don't know what that would break down to. I'm not good at math. Maybe 0.25 mg, somewhere in that area.
Well, you're cutting a 5 milligram in halves? you said?
In half, and then one of the half pieces into thirds.
Yeah, so it's like a half. That's actually less than a milligram.
Yeah, it's very small.
Yeah.
I've been taking it that whole time. I haven't noticed any side effects whatsoever that I can tell. It doesn't mean there some small ones aren't there, but it's nothing noticeable to me.
Well, I find that interesting, and I don't mean to cut you off, but when people say that, you know, if it's not, to me, if a side effect is not noticeable to you, then at least you're not having, to me, you're not having side effects. You don't know what's going to happen in the long run, but at least during that period, if you're not noticing it, and people say that, well, I'm not noticing anything. Maybe something's happening, but I'm not noticing it. I mean, to me, if you're not noticing it, you're not having side effects. So I wouldn't even think, you know, in that direction.
Well, for me, the reason I say that is because I've had a bad back for about 15 years now that's left me in pain 24/7, literally, like every minute of the day for the last 15 years. And that pain also, you know, sometimes leaves me tired, leaves me not really much energy, you know, that area. And I've also read that sometimes Finn maybe can have those effects as well. So I don't know. No noticeable effects in any of the big ways that people often complain about.
Okay, I got it.
I haven't had any of those. But I am starting to lose. I've kind of been in the same, you know, I've held the same spot in my hairline and stuff for the past year or so. I'm starting to lose some ground, I think, on the right side of my hairline where the surgery didn't work. As far as the surgery went, only a couple pieces that they, you know, hairs regrew that they said that they put in my head. On that particular side, and I think I'm starting to lose a little ground there, kind of like where my hair parts in that area. I'm not sure if it's genetics. I'm not sure if it's because I still wear my hair pulled back, like I told you before. I'm not sure if you remember that, but
I do.
I brought that concern up to you as well before. Like, could that be the reason why it's receding a little bit? But
it's unlikely, unless you're really wearing an extremely tight ponytail. It's unlikely that you're causing traction. So I wouldn't worry about that.
No, not tight. But I do cake my hairline with Carafiber, and I sometimes mix that with Dermatch. Like, I just put like kind of Dermatch like on the side, like on my temple area, and then I put that, you know, on top of my head and in my hairline. I do wear quite a bit of it, you know, it blends in really well. I don't think I do a pretty good job with it, and then I put hairspray on top of that to hold it in. So I don't know if all those mixtures combined or maybe might be causing me some problems. That's kind of one of the things I want to ask you about. Do you think that could be possible?
Anything's possible, but I've been using this stuff for many, many years. And I don't think, while I have lost ground over the years, I mean, you have to realize I've been taking this drug for 20 years. Looks
right.
Like I just lost Joe. Let's see if we can get him back on. You know, I don't think that it was the reason that I've progressed had anything to do with Dermatch or any of the products that I'm using. I think that's, you know, it's very unlikely. And I think that you possibly, I can't get him back on. I think that you're possibly just progressing because, you know, maybe you're telling me you're taking a very low dosage of Finasteride.
Yeah, that's the other reason I wanted to call in. I mean, I know what you said earlier about, you know, advising on that situation. I understand your feelings on that, but like, I mean, would you suggest maybe I up it a little bit, like the doses, maybe a little bit, try that?
This is what I would suggest.
You've changed your doses over the years.
I have. I'll tell you what people have done, and I would suggest this. Let me see if Joe's back up. Joe, are you online? Joe, you there? That's so funny, man. He can't hear. I think maybe his mic went off. What I have done over the years, obviously, is I've changed my dosage. I've always believed that Finasteride is dose dependent. No doctor will tell you this, so I'm not a physician, I'm not giving you medical advice. But
right.
I have spoken to many guys, at least anecdotally, who have upped their dosage, especially when they started on such a small dosage like you are on right now, and they've seen positive results without, you know, having any adverse side effects.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you can definitely talk to your doctor about it. I don't see why just taking a quarter of a tablet as opposed to a third of, you're basically taking like a sixth of a tablet by cutting it in half and then cutting those halves into thirds.
Right.
You know, upping it to a quarter, which is like kind of like the usual dose. It'll average out to about 1 milligram, a little bit more some days, a little bit less. I don't see why that would hurt. And you should talk to your doctor about that. But again, I'm not giving you medical advice.
Yeah. Okay. That's why I was kind of torn, because like I said, I know you've upped your doses, so I thought I would contact you about this. Do I just kind of take the fortune of not having any side effects yet and just leaving it where I'm at now, or should I maybe, since I think I am losing more, you know, try to up it a little bit? That's where I've kind of been torn about that, so that's why I decided to contact you on that. I'm totally at a loss. I didn't know what to do with that. So,
well, I think, listen, I don't think there's anything wrong with upping your dose. And again, I'm not a doctor. I have done it myself. I have gone up and down. You know, now I'm at a dosage where I use intermittent therapy, 5 milligrams once a week. I'm actually going to take my Proscar tonight, and it's been great for me. So that averages out to about, you know, a little less than a milligram a day. But, you know, that's really all my body needs right now in order to maintain what I have. You may need more. And that's just, you know, and you're basically taking less than the normally prescribed dosage as it is. So talk to your doctor about that. I don't think he or she is going to say that it's a bad idea to try to go up to a normal dosage. And if you have adverse side effects, then you'll know, but it's probably unlikely that that's going to happen. But that's just, you know, that's just my guess.
Yeah, that's kind of what I figured. Do you think maybe I should stay at the 2 times a week like I've been doing for last year, or maybe should I shoot for 3 times a week now since I'm upping my dose? Or that was another thing I was confused
about. Oh, wait a second.
About.
Okay, I'm lost. So you're taking that small dosage just 2 times a week?
Yes. Yep. I've been doing that for the past year.
Yeah, that's a tiny dose, man. That really is.
A little too cautious on my part.
Well, I'm just saying, you know, that could be why you're progressing. You know, you may need more of the drug in your body. You can talk to your doctor about maybe continuing the same dosage, but just doing it, using it more often. So instead of upping your dosage, maybe take it 3 or 4 days a week as opposed to twice a week.
That's what I thought about doing.
That may be a good way to start.
Yeah, and plus, like, now the pills are over a year old, so they probably won't be as potent, you know what I mean, as they were when I first got them. So maybe upping it to 3 to 4 times a day or times a week. You know, also, since it's not as potent.
Let's just put it this way, dude. The prescribed dosage is 1 milligram a day, 7 days a week. So you are way below the normally prescribed dosage. So it's possible that you're not getting the desired effects because you're not even taking the minimal dose. That's a possibility. So yeah. I would talk to my doctor about that. I can't tell you what to do. But it does seem like if you are losing ground, you have a lot of wiggle room at this point to kind of play with your dosage because you're taking such a small amount.
Right. Exactly. The main side effect I was worried about, I didn't have any, you know, the major side effects that are always talked about. But, like, I've also heard about, like, you can have people experience, mental problems concentrating and fogginess and memory problems. And I just started school a couple months ago, and that's the last thing I need, you know, because I'm struggling enough with the class that I'm taking. So that was my other big concern.
This is my suggestion. Stop reading this crap on the internet.
Yeah.
Okay, that's my suggestion. Yeah. Because if you didn't read about it, you wouldn't think about it, and you wouldn't have this. You know, you're not suffering from foggy brain right now, are you?
I certainly hope not. Okay. I don't think so.
All right, well, then there you go. So then there's nothing to worry about.
Right. Okay.
You know, so stop reading the forums. Stop reading about, you know, about the drug. You've been on it for a year. Talk to your doctor about it. But, you know, I mean, I'm sure he prescribed you the average dosage. And, you know, you might want to consider taking the average dose just to see how you do. And maybe you'll really benefit from it. You know, and you could up it slowly. But again, talk to your doctor. This is not medical advice, but you could up it slowly to at least closer to the actual recommended dosage.
Okay. That's a good idea. I'll give that a shot. I figured that's what I needed to do, but okay.
All right, man. And anything else?
No, that's about it. That was good talking to you again. Thanks for taking my call.
All right, man. Well, listen, good luck. I'm glad, you know, I did read your email. I'm glad that you're kind of moving forward in a direction that is better for you. And,
yeah, it took a while. Kind of crazy how things came about. It's a long story, but yeah, I figured I would go ahead and give it a shot. But thanks, I appreciate that.
All right, man. I wish you the best of luck.
All right, thanks.
Great talking to you. 888-659-3727. I'm having trouble with Joe Tillman. Joe, are you there?
I'm back.
All right.
Yeah, I don't know what was going on with that. It was strange.
Shit happens, dude.
It does.
What are you going to do?
I caught the last of what Chris was saying. Stay off those damn forums when it comes to the side effects and all this stuff.
I wasn't clear. He's telling me that he's taking like a sixth of a Proscar dose twice a week, and he's a sixth. So basically, he's cutting Proscar in half, and then he's cutting the half into thirds.
Okay, so that's like a little bit under three quarters of a milligram.
Right, and he's only taking that twice a week. So I think it's probably pretty safe for him to talk to his doctor about upping it to, at least taking that small amount, maybe daily, and see how he does.
Increasing the frequency, sure.
Exactly.
Well, I didn't realize that. Yeah, that's certainly a small dose for sure.
All right. Well, let's take another phone call and see who this is. Yeah. Hey, you're on the air. Who's this, and where are you calling from?
Hey, Spencer. This is John calling from New York City again.
John, what's up, man?
Hey, John.
Hey, how you doing? Hey, Joe, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Spencer, as you remember, I called a couple of weeks ago to discuss the terrible side effects that Finasteride has given me these past few years.
I do remember.
I appreciated your advice, and as you recommended, I now take one Propecia pill every other day, and that's what I've been doing for the past month. But what I'd like to address tonight, I'd like to maybe vent a little bit, air some grievances.
Go ahead.
Very cool. What I'd like to address tonight is despite the fact that I've heard plenty of success stories using today's hair loss treatments, and don't get me wrong, I'm very happy for the people who have experienced success, the fact is the vast majority of hair loss sufferers feel underserved by today's limited treatments for hair loss.
I believe
you do as well, that most balding men are indeed bothered by their hair loss potentially eroding their outer looks and subsequently their confidence and ability to feel comfortable in their own skin. Yet despite this, I read a statistic on an IAHRS-approved surgeon's website that only 2-7% of all hair loss sufferers opt for today's treatments. This clearly illustrates to me that although most men want to do something about their hair loss, the drastic limitations and flaws and drawbacks of today's treatments do not appeal to the vast majority of hair loss sufferers. I mean, minoxidil, after all, is a very weak vasodilator, and therefore I've never seen it consistently regrow any significant amount of hair for most people.
That's true.
And although finasteride can drastically slow the progression of hair loss for some people, and maybe even stop it in some cases, it does cause significant side effects for some people, as I know through personal experience and those of several friends of mine, and it does not do nearly enough to regrow lost hair. And many people, especially former athletes, view altering their hormonal balance as a very serious thing and do not want to take that kind of risk. Finally, I've heard about hair transplantation.
You mean you're talking about finasteride, not minoxidil, yeah.
Exactly, okay. Finasteride, yeah. And finally, I've heard hair transplantation bandied about as being some type of quote-unquote gold standard, but I don't see how it can be viewed as such if it only appeals to less than 5% of all hair loss sufferers. I mean, the flaws and drawbacks are obvious, the permanent head scarring, the inability to generate anything close to a full head of hair, the extremely high pricing, which I believe to be much more expensive than virtually any other cosmetic procedure.
It is actually the most expensive cosmetic procedure on the market, and that's the way that it is. And you make some really strong points, and these are points that we've been making and I've been making for years. There are limitations. Yeah. Now, there's some when you're talking about surgical hair restoration, a lot of the reasoning I think behind some of the reasoning behind why people don't opt for surgery. Or even consider it is it's based on some of the old obvious work that was done years ago. Now, absolutely. With that said, a lot of guys aren't candidates for surgery either. And there are guys that, people have to understand what the true limitations of surgery are. You have donor supply and you have a demand to meet. And the supply at this point can never meet the full demand of a full-blown, say, Norwood 5 or Norwood 6 in most cases. And Joe could be more specific about that, because Joe's a guy that is a full-blown Norwood 6, who's had multiple surgeries. And if you were to actually meet him in person, you would probably say to yourself, well, you know what, this is a real success story as far as surgical heart restoration is concerned.
And actually, I've seen his pictures, too, and it's really phenomenal, his journey and everything. But it seems like for every case I see with him, there are so many other cases where hair transplantation is basically just transformed a balding man into a thinning man, precisely with what you said, that there just isn't enough hair to relocate to generate a full head of hair. And
I think Joe wants to say something. Go ahead, Joe.
Well, I was just going to say, I mean, John, like Spencer said, you've got some great points. With my case in particular, full blown Norwood 6, and you know, there's some positive comments made about the result, but I'm the first to say that it is not nearly a full head of hair. It's fairly thin front to back. I think that one reason why I've had the success I've had is I've learned how to utilize what I have to its maximum visual potential, right? And I'm not talking comb overs and stuff like that. It's just I know the length that works for me. I know the hairstyles that work for me. And I don't try to do something that the lack of density will not allow.
And you're also very open about imaging. Even though you really do take the best imaging possible, there's still any type of image online could still create a slight illusion of thicker hair.
Absolutely.
Even if it's not something that you mean to do.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's why, you know, it's always imperative to see, you know, if you've seen someone online, like a patient that's highlighting his result, if they're relatively nearby to you, geographically speaking, try to meet them, see how it compares to reality, and then go from there.
Anyway, Spencer, what I was going to say, if I could continue with what I was going to going at.
Sure.
I was going to say, very cool. Thanks, I appreciate it. Despite the extremely limited appeal of today's treatment, I guess what frustrates me the most is there remains to be virtually next to no innovation in the hair restoration field whatsoever.
Well, there's no innovation that you're aware of at this point.
What I see is just really like a handful of companies throughout the world, and I see a commitment of basically, I would say, most hair restoration practitioners to the status quo. And I guess that's what frustrates me the most and is why I try and research potential cutting-edge treatments that could meet the needs of the majority of hair loss sufferers as opposed to a small sliver of a minority. That leads me to a dramatic and extremely fruitful experiment that I told you about several times before. Would you mind if I brought it up again?
I don't mind. Go ahead.
Very cool. Thanks a lot. Okay, in July of 2009, it was reported that Egyptian scientist and dermatologist Marwa Fawzi used the stem cell method to regrow hair in 8 children with alopecia areata. Her methodology was that she took a small biopsy from each child's scalp, isolated the hair follicle stem cells, and multiplied them in culture for about a month, and then re-injected the cells into the bald areas of each child. The results were totally amazing. 5 out of the 8 children regrew at least 50% of their hair back. One child who was previously almost totally bald regrew nearly all of his hair. These results, as I said before, were totally outstanding and were achieved in humans, not lab mice. And although these children suffered from alopecia areata as opposed to androgenetic alopecia, and I'm very well aware of the differences between the two conditions, the methodology that Dr. Fawzi used could very logically be applied to people who suffer from male pattern baldness as well. I mean, she did not use some type of corticosteroid or anti-inflammatory drug that inhibited the immune system from attacking the hair follicles. Instead, she used a form of hair multiplication where healthy hair follicle stem cells were extracted, multiplied, and reinjected. And best of all, since her experiment was performed on children, it really illustrates the safety of it all.
Let me ask you a question as far as follow-up. Now, I know that you read this to me years ago, and if you know anything about alopecia areata, and you say that you do, you know that basically your body is attacking, your immune system is attacking the hair follicles. So no hair follicles are immune to the disease itself. What do you think is making these particular multiplied, if they are actually multiplied follicles, immune to the disease process, as opposed to when you're, using medication that is basically blocking the immune response? That makes sense as far as why the hairs will continue to grow. Why do you think in this case, this particular researcher was able to multiply hair, as you say, and they continue to grow in alopecia areata patients? Was there an explanation for that?
Okay. Actually, what I was going to do, I have the article right here, and I'm in the chat room right now, and I was going to link you this article right here, assuming my computer could work right.
You should definitely link it into the chat room and let everybody read it.
Yeah, that's what I'm going to do. Yeah, what I'm doing right now.
For sure. But I'm saying these are things that you have to kind of put into perspective and think about. You know, what's been the follow-up with this particular researcher? Has this been a long-term, consistent process, or was she able to somehow regrow hair in these patients for a temporary lifespan, meaning that maybe it went through one life cycle, growth cycle, or maybe it didn't even go through an entire growth cycle? Because if you're dealing with alopecia areata, and you're not actually somehow suppressing that mechanism, there's no way that even if you're capable of multiplying thousands and thousands of hair follicles, eventually they are going to be susceptible to the disease process as well.
Yeah. Well, what I was going to say is that the follicles that she multiplied are were resistant to DHT as it is. So that's why.
Yeah, but alopecia.
That's not the reason for the hair loss.
Yeah, alopecia areata. Yeah.
An immune system response. It was alopecia areata, which means that the body's own immune system is attacking the hair, which is causing the hair to fall out. So if you're multiplying, it doesn't matter if it's DHT resistant or not. You're still taking the hair from the same body of the patient, growing more, reinserting it to the scalp, leaving it vulnerable to the same mechanism that caused it to fall out to begin with.
Now, if this researcher was able to do that with DHT-resistant hair on men and women dealing with male or female pattern hair loss, then that makes sense because it correlates with the theory of donor dominance. But in alopecia areata patients, it can't work consistently if in fact she's multiplying hair.
Yeah, see, I'm trying to send you this link here, but it's just... For some reason, it's not copying and pasting here. I'm trying to copy and paste, and for some reason, it's not doing it. But if you do a search, I'm not sure if you have time to do a Google search, maybe during your break or something. But if you do, I could type in the text for you to do like a Google search if you like.
Why don't you type in the text? Tell people to Google this, and they'll Google it. And that's the easiest way to do it. But I just, it needs to be put out there because what you're saying, look, it sounds exciting. I think at one point I did read something that you sent us a long time ago, but we're not hearing anything about it now. Why do you think that this particular researcher stopped her research?
Well, that's one thing that I'm curious about. I'd like to hear whether it was success or a failure, because apparently she did successfully multiply these hair follicles.
Right.
And the fact that she did multiply them is, is a very large hurdle that, a lot of researchers wouldn't be able to do.
No, and I agree, but there's also some researchers, some people who have claimed to be researchers from universities who are connected to universities in India and some other parts of the world who made similar claims. And they actually came out publicly on hair loss forums and other resources claiming that they basically have solved this puzzle and they're able to, they're able to multiply hair, and they basically, have the holy grail for hair loss sufferers. And unfortunately, people put down some, hard-earned money, traveled across the world, and sadly were allegedly conned or misled by these particular researchers / hair transplant surgeons. I'm not saying that this is the case with this woman, but it would be interesting to kind of further your research and see why maybe the research has stopped. Why hasn't anybody else tried to duplicate this?
See that I just like to hear some explanation of it. All I heard was that it was reported on once, and that was it. But it seems to me if she cloned the follicles, she could perform a similar cloning process for, let's say, people with male pattern baldness.
Well, then that would be that is the holy grail. And if she was able to do that, then it would only work for people with male pattern baldness. It would not work, at least for the long term, for people with alopecia areata, but it would work for people with androgenetic alopecia. So yeah, listen, you know, I'll take another look at it for sure.
Yeah, I said. Oh, there we go. The link actually worked. Hallelujah.
Oh, great.
Yeah, it took about like 10 minutes or something, you know. But that's something that really intrigued me the most because I remember a couple of weeks ago, I was going to call you up. I was on the road, but my cell phone battery unfortunately died. And I heard some lady talking about some soap that she used that apparently rejuvenated hair follicles.
Yeah.
You and Joe were kind of dubious of her claims. And I remember you suggested to her that she perhaps presented to Dr. Bob Bernstein, a surgeon who you obviously respect very highly. I was going to tell you that this experiment was actually reported on his website. He actually posted on his website when it happened. So that's, I guess that adds legitimacy to it as well.
Absolutely. You mean the Egyptian experiment?
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, to me, it absolutely does. And I could, if it was posted on his website, this guy, I can guarantee you, it's still somewhere on his website. So okay. I could take a look for it there as well.
Yeah. Even if you do the search, My computer's freezing. I'm trying to send you another link and freezing here.
It's all right. Well, you put the link in the chat room, which is good enough for now. I'm going to take some more calls, but listen, I'm open to anything. I want to hear what you guys have to say, and I'm completely with you. We don't have enough great treatments. I have been very fortunate. Joe Tillman has been very fortunate, but we're still, obviously, we don't have perfect hair. I still have to paint my head, you know? It's the way.
Could I explain just quickly for 2 minutes one last aspect of her experiment?
And then
I'll let you get going. Okay, very cool. Thank you. Because what intrigued me the most of her method was that not only did it result in the multiplication of fully functioning hair follicles, but the stem cells that she injected apparently rejuvenated the hair follicle stem cells that had become dormant due to the effects of hair loss. Researchers like Dr. Katsouralis, as you know, who you know about, have long stated that in areas of the scalp affected by MPB, the stem cells are still there, but the progenitor cells needed to activate them into producing cosmetically acceptable hair are lacking. In Dr. Fawzi, it appears that not only were new follicles created, but the active stem cells that ultimately produced these new follicles apparently migrated over to dormant stem cells and caused them to function normally once again.
You know what? Maybe I'll have Bob Bernstein on to talk about it, since he did report about it on his site. I mean, he would probably have some insight on why things didn't progress.
Well, the last time he reported on it was 2009 when he posted about it, and he says at the end, further testing is needed and a double-blind study using a larger number of patients is planned. And again, this was almost 6 years ago, but the study success could prove to be a turning point in stem cell cloning or hair restoration, blah, blah, blah. So it's, you know, he's just reporting on the results that were reported on to begin with. The only opinion he's got is that, yeah, it could be a turning point, but more testing is needed.
Right. And so far, that's when 2009. So that's that's 6 years ago. So he would be in a position where he would hear about this, as well. So go ahead.
That's really something that I'd like to find out about. You know, if it failed, I just want to know why, or if it, you know, because it really seems so promising to me and could even be ultimately the holy grail, you know, because, I mean, whether it's alopecia areata or MPB, the method she still uses.
Well, let's see, you know, and maybe Joe can do some digging himself, and let's see if we can bring something to the table next week and see if we can find something for you.
Yeah, I sure hope so. Spencer, let me ask you one last thing. I don't mean to be forward or anything like this, but if I emailed you on the Bald Truth Radio website this researcher's email address, would you be able to contact her, or am I too forward? Because I understand you're very busy.
Well, it's nothing to do with whether or not I'm busy or not. But I mean, I could certainly attempt to contact her. But if she's not actively researching. Or even if she is, it's very possible, even though it's coming from me, and I know you think that if I write somebody, someone's going to get back to me right away, it's very possible she's just going to ignore my email like she would with anybody else. But if you want to send me the information, I'd be more than happy to give it a shot.
All right, very cool. I totally appreciate it.
All right, man?
Okay.
All right, you take care.
All right, thanks a lot.
All right, take care.
See you, John.
Okay. Got some more calls, but I love when that guy calls in. He's obviously very informed. He does a lot of research. He wants something like everybody else. He wants something now. He realizes the limitations of what we have. But I also think it's important that people understand that with all the limitations, as far as the treatments that we have today, there's still a lot of people that are being helped. And yeah, just because only 2 to 7% of the guys out there who are dealing with male pattern baldness are attempting to do anything about it, it doesn't mean that that's the reason. There's a plethora of reasons why people choose not to move forward or try to help themselves when it comes to hair loss. A lot of it has to do with perception. A lot of it has to do when it comes to surgery with a lot of misperception that's continuing to be perpetuated out there online. There's a lot of tremendous fear when it comes to finasteride now. So there's a lot of reasons behind that.
I think there's a combination of factors. And I think the first one you touched on is the most prevalent factor, and that's just a lack of awareness.
Yeah.
Because how many times have you heard me talking about how hair restoration is perceived in the popular media? You know, it's not plugs anymore. You know,
sure.
Latest thing from blah, blah, blah. And, you know, comic relief in movies and TV. I mean, people still, unless they actually know someone went through it or, you know, have some sort of connection. If they don't, they still think it's plugs.
Look, even this latest article in GQ, a guy ends up, you know, the reporter goes to Bosley, goes through the entire process, and he's a happy patient. But even the way he writes about it, it's relatively demeaning to the procedure.
Yeah. Yeah,
and
absolutely.
And it's unfortunate because, you know, but I guess people and journalists and men in general in society feel they need to somehow qualify it by, you know, demeaning it to some degree. And then saying, well, you know, it's really not that bad. It's not what we thought it was. And which is fine. But instead of just going out there and saying, listen, science and medicine has really evolved to the point where surgical hair restoration is no longer what it used to be. It is truly a process that a lot of men can benefit from.
And that the science can actually support the artistry.
That's right.
You know, and, you know, I'd like to address what John was talking about, the last caller.
Sure, my cat's going crazy in the studio, so.
I thought I heard something.
Yeah.
No, but, you know, I like listening to him. He's very well spoken. He's got a very unique manner of expressing himself that I find.
It's good radio.
Yeah, it is very. Yeah, it's good radio.
Yeah.
But what he's talking about with this researcher and how it was on Dr. Bernstein's website, like I pointed out 9 or 6 years ago, and can we follow up on this to see where it is? I think that, unless I misunderstood, I think it represents what some people are thinking is that, you know, for all of the information that's out there, there's still that little secret, that secret cure that no one knows about, only a select few know about.
And I also think it's important that
if we dig enough, we'll find it.
That if listeners understand that, you know, yes, I do think that, you know, it may add some credibility that Bob Bernstein decided to write about it on his website, but also, you know, people will make posts on their sites because it does help to bring traffic to their site. And he's not going to post about anything that's, you know, really questionable or snake oils or anything like that.
Right.
And obviously this was something of real interest to him. But it doesn't necessarily mean that it's something that, you know, is going to ever come to fruition or has a tremendous amount of credibility just because a credible doctor posted about it. I mean, it's the internet.
It's good radio for the web. It's good web.
It's good content.
It's good content, and it's good for SEO. Honestly,
that's exactly it.
And for those that don't know, search engine optimization. Google likes content, and blah blah blah. And I could talk about it for hours. But yeah, there are multiple reasons why he talked about it, and part of it is there might be some slight legitimacy to it. Legitimacy to it, just in that it's something good to read. It's interesting, and he does put a caveat at the end that more research is needed, and that's the way it should be looked at.
Absolutely, absolutely. All right, let's take another phone call. Let's see who this is. Hey, you're on the air. Who's this, and where are you calling from?
Hey, man, it's Tim from Boston.
Tim from Boston,
Tim.
Welcome. How are you?
Good, man. We're getting a massive blizzard up here.
Oh, my God. I know. Holy cow. I'm so glad I live on the West Coast.
Yeah. Don't move back, ever.
it's not going to happen, dude.
There's 32 inches of snow on the ground. It's insane.
Oh, my God.
32 inches. Jeez.
Yeah.
I think de Blasio is basically, it's almost like martial law in New York. You get arrested if you go out in the streets.
Yeah, I read that.
Yeah. Well, there's a travel ban on the road. You can't leave your house. Yeah.
It's insane.
They don't want anyone on the roads. Yeah.
Wow.
It's definitely the most snow I've ever seen.
Wow.
Definitely.
Well, it's an experience.
Well, man, I'm just calling, I'm calling for a few reasons. One is because, I routinely shave my head, or I have been at least for the past 13 months or so.
Right.
I noticed an issue 2.5 years ago, just before my 24th birthday. Little background. I don't know if I've ever spoke when Joe was on the air, but
I think you have.
Oh, have I? And anyway, so I grew my hair out. Just because I had gone back to school and had this time over break where I really wasn't doing anything, and so I was pursuing jobs and stuff, and in that meantime my hair just sort of grew out, and it looked pretty good, you know. Before New Year's, I was like, hey, you know, this doesn't even really look like, you know, I'm balding really, and
that's all right.
But whenever it gets to this certain length, it becomes evident. You know,
right.
It's the miniaturization at I don't know, maybe when the hair gets to about 1.5 inches long, just at about combable length,
right.
It becomes evident to me. To others, maybe not so much. But what's unsettling about this last time I grew my hair out was that I think that I have diffuse, unpatterned alopecia on the sides of my head.
Interesting. So so you didn't notice that before?
Well, here's the deal. I think I've mentioned to you that I don't even think it doesn't bother me too much because I shave my head. I mean, it bothers me to the extent that, you know, it's, you know, as it would bother anybody, but I think I don't think I was ever really a hair transplant candidate, even though I saw Scott Bowden
right.
in Connecticut, and he never mentioned it, but at the time, you know, I was shaved down to about a 1 with a clipper, so, and I had seen another surgeon here in Massachusetts who didn't mention it either, but at that time my hair was really long, and I had only been on the medication for about a year.
Right.
But yeah, I took some pictures, and I don't know if it's just because I have dark hair. My mother's from Northern Ireland, her family, and so the skin is very, very fair, like ghostly white, and then pitch black hair. It's easy to see through it.
Well, that's the thing. There's a major contrast, and actually, I mean, you're saying that you're a diffuse sufferer anyway. You're not probably not a candidate for a transplant, but if you were a candidate,
right,
makes it some of the worst, most difficult hair to move, because you really do see the contrast between dark hair
right.
and light skin.
Is your hair coarse as well, or is it fairly fine?
No, it's fine. Yeah, I'm like the worst possible candidate. But okay.
Coarse hair. Coarse hair is the worst possible candidate, but you're still close. With the jet black hair on fair skin.
I wouldn't say it's hard to say. I wouldn't say it's jet black. It's just when it's short, and I guess living here in the winter,
yeah,
it looks black, you know?
Yeah.
But, you know, California, which is where my dad's wife is from, it wouldn't look black at all. It would actually look relatively...
That's all right.
I was looking at my phone. Did I do that?
Yeah.
Well, I'm not going to tell you to go out and get a tan, but you know. But what you can do is you could always, if you wanted to, you could always lighten your hair a little bit too to lessen that contrast,
right.
And that does make a significant, I think, visual impact when someone does lighten their hair. But there's also, I think, there's risks involved depending on how you do it.
Well, the funny thing too that I wanted to mention too is that you know, I have my dad look at my hair with magnification, I don't know what they use. They use the camera. They go in there with the camera when you see the hair transplant surgeon. I forget what that's called. Yes. My father doesn't have one. He's a dermatologist, doesn't have one of those, but has a magnifier and, you know, has whatever tools he uses when he's in the office, and I have him look at my hair.
Does he have an iPhone?
Maybe every 6 months.
If your dad has an iPhone, you can buy an attachment, which is like a mini densitometer. And attach it to his iPhone, and he'll be able to really get a good densitometer-like image directly on his iPhone screen.
Yeah, maybe I'll have him do that. But I was going to say the funny thing about it is he never, you know, he always says, you know, it doesn't appear there to be any, you know, on the sides of your head or on the back of the head or on the top of your head, like in the back, you know, there doesn't seem to be any noticeable miniaturization to me.
Right.
You have fine hair, you know, so it just looks this way to me. But, you know, when I looked at the side of my head and I took a picture of it, you know, it's sort of what the hair looks like is it sort of clumps together in certain spots. And then there's like lines of scalp. It's bizarre.
Well, you know, you know, Andrew Zarian, right? From GFQ. Well, he actually has his own densitometer and he purchased one on Amazon. You can get one, just hook it up to your laptop. And they're pretty inexpensive. And you can actually, you can check for miniaturization yourself.
Yeah.
I mean, if you really want to depress yourself, you can do that.
Yeah. I don't know if I want to do that.
I think you're better. The fact that you're able to shave your head and live your life and still have a good life, to me, you win.
Yeah.
You win.
Yeah. I mean, I've never gone down with a razor. I want to make it clear, you know, I've gone down with a zero.
Right.
But I've never, you know, and I still have, I don't know, half my hairline, three quarters of my hairline, maybe more. Maybe I'm exaggerating the actual condition of it. But, you know, it's not like I'm, you know, completely bald. And, you know, I don't know what that would look like on me. I know that, you know, I can pull it off. And nobody ever really has anything bad to say, you know, so.
Yeah.
You know what the funny thing is, too, about it all, but and this is another point I wanted to make, is, you know, I see all these guys with expensive hair loss who aren't treating their condition, you know, if you want to call it a condition. I guess it is.
Sure.
That you know of.
Yeah. Former roommates, certain, about 100% sure they're not treating it unless they've been treating it in the last few months, but they don't, you know, the women they date or hang out with, they don't really seem to care. And it's bizarre to me because you'd think that looks would play this like huge role. Maybe it's because it does for men.
Yeah.
And I think it plays such a small role for women. It's sort of this conclusion that I'm coming to because I see so many men out there that you know, just don't have a lot of hair.
Right.
But they have a lot of I have this one friend who was 17 when he started losing his hair, is completely bald. His father is completely bald. His brother is completely bald. And I haven't seen him in many years. And he comes back, and I see him, and he makes such this, like, incredible impression on me, just how mature he is. And he has a girlfriend. And I don't know. I just...
Well, I mean, this is the type of guy that's probably emotionally equipped to deal with it, especially since he saw so much of it in his family.
His family, right. I mean, I guess for me it's a little more difficult considering nobody in my family really immediate family has it. But
And I was the same way. I didn't, you know, my dad was balding, but I didn't really realize it because he had a full hairline. So he would just comb his hair back. So my entire life, while he may have had a bald spot, and maybe one was developing when I was younger, but by the time I, you know, noticed my hair loss, I realized, wait a second, this guy's bald himself. But I had no real...
Did your brother at the time have hair loss or not? No,
brother actually started to lose hair later than I did. So when I started to lose my hair, my brother was 4 years older than me. He still wasn't losing his hair. So he started to lose it, I'd say, in his late 30s, maybe early 40s.
Tim, the friend that you're talking about, it was probably a rite of passage to manhood in the family, since the father and the brother were the same way. It's like, aha,
right.
now you're becoming a man. you know?
Right. The funny thing, too, about it is I tried to explain that to my own people in my own family, because a lot of what I get a lot when I shave my head is, well, why did you shave your head? Because nobody can believe. It's like, how, you know, Tim's got three older brothers who are in their 40s. I'm in my mid-20s. And I have this father, and both my grandfathers had full heads of hair. So anybody who really knows my family, especially close relatives, always say, why are you doing this to yourself, you know?
Yeah, like you're somehow disfiguring yourself by shaving your head.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, people who aren't really close with my family or our family don't really say anything. In fact, I had one girl who's completely gorgeous. I shaved it down and I had it boxed out with a zero, just no guard on the clipper. And I came into class the next day and she was like, oh, it looks good.
Yeah.
So,
and that's it, man. You know, That's it. You are one of those guys. You are one of the lucky ones. And I love when you call the show. You're great on the air. I think you offer a lot, especially for the younger guys. And what I think you offer most is, yeah, you're still concerned about it, but you've also been able to live your life.
You're dealing.
Yeah, I think. Well, yeah. I mean, I was just going to say, like, my hope would be to strengthen up my hairline, you know, and maybe in my 30s have a hair transplant. But I guess part of me feels like, maybe I really am headed towards, you know, complete, Norwood 7, because that's where these distant relatives on my maternal grandmother's side went to, you know. They went all the way.
Yeah, and once you go all the way, man, there's no coming back. That's just the way that it is.
And I guess
you don't want to, why limit yourself? Even if you decide to have a state-of-the-art FUE where the scarring is so minimal, you're still limiting yourself to having to wear your hair a certain way. As opposed to being able to just shave it.
Yeah, I was just going to say, if I do that, I've eliminated this option I've had for myself. And I think the last thing I just wanted to say, too, is, like, I have this funny thing where when I grow my hair out, I'm constantly worrying about it. I don't know why that is. It's like, I think because I like the way I look with it, I look good with it. Obviously, I think most people look good with hair, you know?
There's a pretty... I don't know if you've ever watched Seinfeld, because you're a younger guy, but you probably have.
I do watch.
There's an episode where Elaine is dating a guy that had shaved his head, for like a decade, because he was a swimmer. And she saw his driver's license and happened to notice that in his driver's license picture, he had a very thick head of hair. So she suggested, why not grow your hair out? He tried to grow his hair out, and he realized he was losing his hair. And then he went through a deep, dark funk. Now, the guy was a totally well-functioning guy while his head was shaved. And then once he realized he had this lack of control, you know, and you saw the episode, obviously. He's, you know, walking around with stains on his shirt. He's depressed. He's despondent. It's that lack of control, you know. I would say, you know, in general, every time you call, you always seem like you're in good spirits. And you always seem like, listen, it sucks. I'd rather have a full head of hair, but you know, even just said it. You know, some chick you don't even know just happened to say you look good.
Right. Well, I mean, I think the thing that's sort of weird about it too is that whenever I just get rid of it and sort of say, well, this is how it is, and I'm just, you know, I'm going to have to live my life this way, it seems to go better for me, because it's kind of you. I guess I have sort of this attitude where if like somebody doesn't like me for it, I'm not gonna like them back, you know what I mean?
Sure.
So,
well, if someone doesn't like you because of it, then they got, you know, they got bigger issues in their life,
right? Exactly. Or I mean, you know, if somebody's not attracted to me for it, then why would I be? I sort of developed that attitude. I think most people would, but it feels better kind of than when I grow my hair out and I'm like, oh man, you know, can they see that little thing that I see, or that it looks a little funny right here? And but I constantly want to go to the bathroom and make sure it looks just right.
Look, you're talking to a guy. I'm not talking about myself, but I'm talking about Joe, who walked around at your age. How old are you?
Me? I'll be 27 in September.
Okay.
Oh, my God.
Younger than you, with, like, a cornrow plug job. And he still got laid and went out and lived his life, somehow figured it out. So, I mean, you're talking about a guy who had to learn how to deal in a way that, unfortunately, more guys than you would think have to learn how to deal.
Ether rag.
Yeah.
What was that?
Ether rag.
Ether rag. Well, yeah, I guess that would work. Yeah.
I had this, I started going to the gym again. I work out with, like, I have a small weight set here that I use, but I started going to the gym to lift heavy weight. And one thing I noticed, too, is, like, you know, there's a lot of guys who are either completely bald or, especially in the gym, it seems like.
Yeah.
But there's this thing, too, like, this sort of paradox I kind of see where a lot of guys who have hair kind of let themselves go in older age.
That's interesting.
Physically.
Yeah.
And a lot of guys, I just noticed this kind of observantly in the gym, you know what I mean? I mean, I do a bike class too. And, then, you know, the guys who don't have hair kind of take care of themselves a little better. And they almost look better in a lot of ways.
They're and younger. Better. Yeah.
Their body looks better.
I would say that's a very interesting point that you just made, because I would say most guys that I grew up with, like when I go back to a high school reunion, who have no signs of hair loss, who really maintained a really youthful hairline, those are the guys that are the most out of shape, and those are the guys who are the biggest alcoholics.
Thinking of that in my own case, that's exactly right. I mean, I've got a lot of the guys from high school on my you know, I'm still in contact with them, and every one of them that have all their hair, and unfortunately, there's a lot of them. Just kidding. it seems like they've kind of let themselves go. Whereas, like my best friend, who I had my first two transplants with to begin with, he's a bodybuilder, 45 years old, and you know, benches 400. And I mean, he's like ripped, and a lot of the other guys that have. You know, moved on in life, even though they lost hair from when we were in high school, they too seem to be a bit fitter, a bit healthier, a bit more conscious of what they're putting in their bodies.
Well, you know, there is that school of thought, and I think it's really an ignorant way to see things, where people are like, and you see this on the forums from a lot of young guys, oh, why do I have to compensate? You know, well, you know, most people have to compensate for something in life. And if you are taking better care of yourself because of your hair loss, if you consider that compensating, then it's not such a bad thing. You know, you're developing better lifestyle choices. You're taking better care of yourself. You know, I mean, listen, I know guys, like I said, all the guys that have no hair loss are total messes at once they reach their 40s. I don't know what it is. I don't know what it is. Now, I have guys, some of my friends were kind of like me. They started Propecia at a young age. They may have saved most of their hair. They were able to kind of maintain a semblance of a full-looking head of hair. But still, they decided to take care of themselves because we just never know when it's going to end for us.
Right.
So we need to stay in shape.
The one thing, too, is I think it's like this level of comfort because, you know, I'm not saying I kept my hair for a long time, but a lot of my friends who were losing their hair sort of started noticing it earlier than I did. You know, mine sort of came on quickly.
Right.
And it came on after college. So I went all through, I had guys in college. Like I have this friend, a good example of a friend is this guy I know, Mike, who I met my junior year of college, who's a year younger than me. But this is a guy who isn't particularly handsome in the traditional sense. He's tall.
Right.
You know, but he's, I know what that is. He's 23, 24. And his girlfriend is unbelievably attractive. But you know what I think it is too is this sort of, he never seems comfortable, I guess, in himself. Like not that I'm saying that he's not comfortable with himself, but he's never satisfied with, you know, he always thinks that he can do more professionally.
Right.
So he's
always striving to improve himself and to better himself in life. It's not that
he's ambitious.
Yeah, exactly. It's not that he's insecure, but he's ambitious. No, he's a hard worker.
Not in an unhealthy way.
Right.
Right. Yeah. And I think, you know, from a male perspective, I admire that in a lot of ways, you know? So I don't know what it is, but I think there's this sort of, and I don't think I've reached that point yet, honestly. You know, I admire it in a lot of ways. I'm trying to get there. Or at least it's something that I want to have, you know?
Well, ambition is, it's an important thing, man. It really is. And, you know, very few guys really have it. You know, that really does separate, in my view, the men from The Boys as far as really living the best life possible.
And and I think the thing is too is like I think the big concern with hair loss is A, not feeling comfortable with who you are, and then the second big concern for guys is what are the women going to think?
Exactly.
So yeah, I find that people seem happiest at least when they're not really thinking about their appearance or themselves, and they're kind of just living. So they're more comfortable with themselves. And the second part is women like guys who are not really focused too much on them, but have some sort of purpose. At least in my early experience, when you're too focused on trying to find a girl, it never seems to go well. And then when you seem to never be looking or you're not looking at all, it kind of seems to fall into place. So,
well, I got to tell you, I mean, you're certainly wise beyond your years. I know you're 27 now, but I mean, you've learned a lot in a relatively short period of time. And there's no doubt about that. There's no doubt. I mean, if you walk into a bar, and this is like on the most basic level. If you walk into a bar and you are look like you're a hound, you're just, you know, you're trying to talk to every woman, you're not going to get anything. If you just walk up to the bar and start ordering a drink, chatting up with the bartender, you know, making it like you own the place and you don't care who talks to you, 9 out of 10 times you're going to get more attention. That's just the way that it works. And that's the way it works in life. You know, busy guys, successful guys, guys that have something going on are the guys that women are attracted to.
And they're not the ones that coming up trying to force conversations with people that aren't interested. You know, it's like, I mean, don't give it all away up front. Let them come and get it.
Look, this isn't meant to sound obnoxious, but I'm an exceptionally ambitious person. I have been since I was a young man. And, you know, hair loss really was my vehicle to, you know, move in the direction that I needed to move into become successful in life. And, I kind of turned my Achilles heel into my profession and into my obsession. But I did it in a very positive way, and I developed what I developed over the years. You can go either way. You know, I could have been Joe from Staten Island. I could have gone in that direction because that's how much it affected my life. I'm sorry?
Right. I was just going to say you got to keep moving forward. You definitely don't want to. I mean, there's definitely moments, I think, for every guy who goes through this where you feel like this could be, it's like, it feels like the world is coming down on you, you know?
Yeah.
It does feel like that. I think to at least everybody who's on the show, you know, it's felt like that at some point.
The show or the forums, it's like the end of the world, right?
Look, I would not be able to have this program for almost 20 years if that wasn't the case for more people than who are willing to admit. Because for everyone who calls this show, there are thousands of people who are listening. That's just the way it is in radio in general. You know,
and nodding their head in agreement.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know?
But I think the bigger fear, though, for me is you know, letting that perpetuate or letting it go on to a point where, you know, everybody wants to be successful and be happy. It really isn't dependent on your hair. It really isn't.
No, it's not.
It's a funny paradox. It's a very personal thing. Nobody really, the funny thing is, I wish I could swear because I was about to, but nobody really gives a.
You can swear, go ahead.
Nobody gives a shit.
Right.
Nobody else, I feel like nobody else, like other people, I don't really care about other people's hair loss.
No, but the thing is, you know, it is true. It is possible that you're not going to get certain women. Certain women may not find you attractive. That's just the way that it is. It doesn't mean they're bad people. It's just the way that it is. But there are very hot women that will find you attractive, even if you're not good looking at all.
Well, yeah, and I honestly think too, it's like the majority of women. I don't think that it's like, I think it's a small percentage of women who think, well, if a guy doesn't have hair, I really do think that.
Once you get to my age, you see the women who with certain guys, and you realize, you really see this a lot. Some of the hottest women are with some of the less physically attractive guys. It's just the way that it works.
And the ones that are very vocal about how hair loss is a turnoff to them tend to be the kind, at least what I've seen, that you'd see on Jersey Shore. right? Like, oh, he's got no hair. I don't want anything to do with him.
Well, that and also they're usually, this is going to sound terrible, a lot of them have a tremendous amount of flaws themselves, physical flaws. A lot of them are overweight. Really hot women, I'm telling you, I don't know what it is, and maybe it's because they, you know, the hotter these chicks are, the more insecure they are. I don't know what it is, but it just, guys think they can't get great-looking girls because they're not as attractive as they'd like to be. And just because a girl doesn't look at you when you walk into a room or when you go into a bar, it doesn't mean you can't eventually get them.
Well, you look at the surveys done with a lot of women. They talk about what do you find attractive, and more times than not, they talk about personality. They talk about confidence. They talk about the presence that one carries about them. And hair is not usually one of the things that they talk about.
But what happens with a lot of guys? They think that they're not going to have the opportunity because they're not getting a second glance. They're walking in a mall, whatever it is, no one's looking at them, and you see people writing about this on the forums. Let me tell you something. A woman may talk about, you know, Tom Cruise or whoever is hot these days. And a woman may, you know, they may kibitz about all kinds of stuff like that. But in the end, whether a girl gives you a second look or not, if you can work your way in there, eventually, if you're an attractive person, she's going to find you attractive. Period. Yeah. You don't have to have a full head of hair. You don't have to have a face like a model or look like a bodybuilder. And guys don't get that. That's a big secret that most guys don't understand.
Well, the thing I was going to say, too, is just like the last point I want to say is always kind of just in my own personal attraction to women is like, you know, a lot of guys will be attracted to a certain woman and I'm not attracted to them, you know, or some guys will say, look at so-and-so. And I'll be like, yeah, but what about her over there? You know what I mean?
Sure.
And I think women are sort of the same way. I think that's human nature, is to sort of be like, you never know. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Some girl doesn't have to be the best looking girl. If somebody seems unique to me or different, then that's going to spark my interest, to be honest. So I think if you own yourself, then it's going to help you.
I agree, man. And you always bring a lot to the show, man. I really appreciate you calling. And be careful out there. I guess you're snowed in for how many days now?
Well, it started last night. Travel ban tonight. Everything, all the schools are closed 2 days in a row, maybe Thursday.
That's heavy.
We'll see what happens.
All right, Tim, listen, man, thanks for the call. As always, yep. And I think you help a lot of young guys who are listening. So keep it up.
All right, take it easy.
See you later.
888-659-3727. I want to take a break, but I'll take another call, and I'm going to hold in my piss right now because I gotta take a piss. But let me just say, this guy's been holding on forever. Let's see who it is. Hey, you're on the air. Who's this, and where are you calling from?
Yes, sir. If you have to go to the bathroom, please go. Don't make a mess for your wife now.
Oh my God, Joe. are you hiding your number? Are you calling me from your house? What's going on?
No, I'm calling you from my mother's house. Because my cell phone went dead.
Oh, my God. What's happening, Joe? How are you?
Hello, Joe.
How are you?
I'm good, sir. How about yourself?
Happy New Year. Well, I'm calling to discuss, as you know, this is for you, Joe, too, to hear this.
Uh-huh.
I'll be meeting personally the next 2 weeks. I can't say what day for security reasons or what place. The doctor will come into my hotel room, the great Dr. Alan Bauman, to examine me personally and present me with a laser cap.
Well, mazel tov. I'm glad that worked out for you, dude.
Now, this is questions for Joe.
Yeah.
Joe, what can I expect? I've been to several examinations. What can I expect him to be doing under this examination?
That might be different from what you've had in the past?
Well, in the past, like Dr. Alan Fell, another good friend of mine, flopped through my hair for about 15 minutes. He said I get at least 1,500 to 2,000. Mm-hmm. But the difference with him and Alan Fell, Alan does beard grafts. So Alan suggested I grow my hair for 5 to 7 days, facial hair. Please comment on that, Joe.
Well, I mean, I can't really comment too much because I don't know Dr. Bauman's style and what his protocol is for examinations. But what I can tell you,
before Joe goes on, I will say that I hope that he has a witness in the room. First of all,
maybe security guard.
Don't scare Alan now, Spence. I'll wear my police T-shirt. Alan knows I'm on the level. Please.
No, I'm not trying to scare. I'm just saying. I just hope he has a witness in the room, just in case. You know, I mean, I think it's important for all parties involved.
You've met with me many times. You know, I'm a dangerous person. I'm not a normal person. I'm obsessed by hair loss, but I'm a relatively
I don't think you're physically dangerous. No.
I'm not. I'm buying Alan lunch, take him out for lunch and everything. I know exactly what he's going to say before he even says it.
All right, let Joe respond.
Yeah, well, I was just going to say he'll probably go over the basics, you know, give you an idea of the supply versus demand situation, talk to you about what your expectations are. Gauge your donor zone, look at the density. He might pull out a densometer to measure everything that you can see on a screen that he might have with him. Don't know how portable it will be, but mainly he'll be asking about what you hope to achieve. And I assume you're talking surgical assessment, because with the laser cap, it's just, you know, here, go with it. But surgically, I mean, you know, he's primarily FUE, so he'll be talking to you about how he's modified his neograft and what he's accomplishing with that. And it'll be pretty straightforward. I mean, unless he's doing some things I'm not aware of, it'll be all about making sure you understand what he does. And if you don't, he'll educate you.
I think he's just going to want to take selfies with you, Joe. He's just going to want to take selfies with you and put them on Facebook. What's going to happen.
Define selfies. What does that mean?
That's taking an image of yourself using your iPhone or a similar smart device.
Well, I'm going to buy a portable camera and have people else help take pictures of us and have it developed to give it to Alan the next day. How does that sound?
Okay. Well, people don't use film anymore, Joe.
Well, I do, as you know. So I still carry a fanny pack.
Yeah, that's true. Well said.
One question for Joe, well, even for you, yeah. Spencer. This is for you, Spencer, I think, too. He wants to grow my facial hair for 5 to 7 days. Is that for beard hair transplants, I'm assuming?
Well, I don't think it's because he wants to see you with the Don Johnson look, dude. I think he wants to assess whether or not you're going to have enough donor hair in your beard to maybe make something out of it.
Well, the time I see him, I'll look like Santa Claus. What does that tell you?
Well, then that's going to tell him that he's going to have a lot of beard hair to work with.
I actually wouldn't grow it out like Santa Claus, because if it's too long, then it can cover up any sort of spaces that would misrepresent the density.
That's a good point.
Yeah.
So what do you advise, Joe? His nurse told me, his beautiful nurse, Linda, whom I love dearly, told me between the 5 and 7 days, she asked Alan. Is that correct, Joe?
Well, I can't say if it's correct, because I don't know the protocol that they follow, but I can say it makes sense, because if you shave your face clean, it takes 5 to 7 days to get a very strong and, I guess, quantifiable density a length that will allow him to be able to look at it and say, okay, you got good donor hair for beard hair.
Now, did he ask you to grow your back hair out as well?
Yes, I'm growing that out too, because the norm is I have 1,500, 2,000. I think I have more than that personally. I'm a hair loss expert, as you know. I think I have more than that.
So Joe, at this point in your life, you're willing to go under the knife again, so to speak.
Okay. Yes. Well, let me ask you one question, Spencer. I don't want him shaving the top of my head. My studies have shown, Joe, please interject on this, that you can do a FUE hair transplant without shaving the top of the head. Is that correct, gentlemen?
Well, it has nothing to do with shaving the top of the head. It has to do with the extraction. Right? I mean, when you're dealing with FUE, you have to shave the donor zone so you can safely get the follicle without having to, you know, it's like trying to pull out a piece of spaghetti a piece of spaghetti out of a full bowl. It's like, how do you find this? It's crazy, right? But when it's buzzed down, you can get to it fine. But what you're talking about is the recipient site shaving, which does allow for a bit of an easier time for the doctor, because he doesn't have to, again, fuss with the length of the existing hair, combing it several times just to make one incision, combing it several times to place a graft that incision. And then when you multiply that by the 2,000 to 3,000 grafts that you may be hoping to get, that's a lot of hair brushing. That's a lot of time wasted. That's a lot of potential shock.
Joe, if he shaves my hair may never regrow.
Why is that?
Because, as Spencer knows, you know, I've told you, in 25 years it's remained the same length, 2 to 3 inches.
No, but what Joe is telling you is that he would, at a minimum, have to shave your donor region in order for extraction. Yeah.
Joe, could I please have my head not shaved? I read online there's doctors who don't shave heads. Is that correct?
Well, I think that all doctors, that, you know, even the ones that are known for shaving, I know for a fact, actually will do a procedure density dependent of the native hairs if it's under a certain number of grafts. So I'm not aware of any clinics that absolutely insist on every case sight unseen. There are exceptions to every rule. In your case, I'm not familiar with how much hair you have on your scalp. I'm not familiar with what Dr. Bauman is comfortable working with, shaved or not shaved. So that's something that'll have to be between you and he.
Well, of course, doctor-patient confidentiality will be invoked. Right, Spencer?
That's up to you.
Exactly, but yeah.
You can understand why we're being in a secret location. We can't announce that on the air because sufferers will be around us. Am I correct?
I don't know if you're correct, but I could certainly understand why you wouldn't want to announce it on the air. And I think it's a good idea for both you and for Dr. Bauman. And frankly, I can't even believe he's going to be meeting you in a hotel room. That's all I'm going
to
say.
Have you spoken to him? It's true. I'm making it up.
I have spoken to him. And, you know, you would contact me saying that he would like to speak with me. And we did speak. And so, and everything that you told me was true, that apparently you guys are going to be meeting up sometime in February.
First, well, you know the date. He's presenting with the laser cap in person. What do you think about that?
I think it's very interesting.
That's impressive service.
Yeah. And
should we call you from the room, Spencer, or what?
Am I what?
Should we call you from the room?
No. I don't want any involvement in it whatsoever.
Well, Alan might do a follow-up in the show, if that's possible.
Well, he can definitely call into the show. He can do a follow-up. You know, you're going to have to give him permission that is going to coincide with HIPAA laws.
I'll sign a HIPAA waiver for you.
Not for me. You have to sign it for him. And then, you know, if he's willing, if you allow him to talk about your case, then great. If not, we're not going to do it.
No, I allow him to talk about my case, but I want no photos shown, no photos taken or shown.
I don't even understand why. I mean, for you not to have photos taken, I mean, just for your own, for your self-assessment, just to see what's going on if you decide to have surgery. I mean, it's crazy not to have photos taken, Joe.
Well, maybe I'll have photos taken, but I don't want them put online for the sufferers to see. Fair enough?
It is fair, but why wouldn't you want to help the sufferers if you could?
Well, that's a good point, Spencer. I'll have to debate that. What do you think?
You just heard what I think.
I hope Alan likes a good steak. I'm taking him to Morton Steakhouse. I'll be thinking about you, Spencer, when I take him there.
Why? I'm sure he likes a good steak, and I'm sure he's going to see you have a couple of drinks, Joe.
No, I'm not going to drink anything in front of Alan, as a matter of fact. I won't embarrass myself in front of the man who's performed surgery on me. Good idea?
I think that would be a great idea. Now, what about the pills and the fanny pack?
No pills. I'll be totally lucid.
Okay.
Fair enough?
Yeah, well, I mean, I hope that's okay for Dr. Bauman. I mean, I don't think I've ever seen you completely sober, so I don't know what that's like.
If he wants to go out for a couple of them with me after the fact, that I'll take it into consideration.
Oh, so you're talking about during the consultation you're going to be sober. Yes, of course you should be sober during the consultation. But at dinner,
of course I am.
But at dinner, you can do whatever you want.
Right. I know he's going to say already. What I want to know is how many beer grapes he's going to tell me. That's a very interesting thing, the beard.
Well, how do we know? What do we think? I have a fucking crystal ball here, Joe?
You know what I look like, Spence. You've met me several occasions.
I never really examined your beard. I mean, I see you staring at me, you know, pretty hard, but I'm not that type of guy.
You're not returning the favor.
Yeah.
Joe, I was studying Spencer's hair.
Guys.
Well, who doesn't?
He's about to put a microscope.
Well, Spencer, give me one more minute. You know what Alan said is true. I am meeting Alan. That's a fact.
Yes, you are meeting him, yes.
I'm flattered. You know why?
He said, good for you, Joe. Good for you.
Well, let me finish my statement. He said I'm some kind of celebrity. He can't wait to meet me. I said, thanks to Spencer Kobren, I'm a celebrity worshipped by Maine's. Thanks to you, Spencer, I said. Am I correct?
Well, I'm glad that you said that to him, but I understand that you haven't said that to other people in the past. So,
I have said it to you, because you made me the star I am today.
You did write that in your last email. You did. You certainly did.
I said you are the star. I am a celebrity today.
Look, Joe, I'm just saying, I heard some things. That's all I'm saying. I heard some things.
What did you hear? Did you meet me in New York? My feelings were hurt.
I heard some things. That's all I'm going to say.
Is that true? From Dave Artista?
What did you say to Dave Artista?
That was a bad holiday joke on my part.
Okay.
I take it back.
I'm just saying, I heard things. I heard things. What am I going to say?
I heard things about you. All I said was my feelings were hurt. You couldn't meet me in New York. And all I said was, I don't like talking the way the show was going. Just talking about transplants for a picture. I want to spend more time in future treatments. That's all I said to Dave Artista. I don't know what it is. I'm mad at Dave anyway. I don't know what he said. He changed everything I said around.
I don't know. He read some stuff verbatim, Joe. That's all I'm saying. Look.
We're old friends, you know, for 18 years, man. The nonsense should come between us.
Am I letting anything come between us? Have I not always been the bigger man?
You are, because I love you, man. I don't love you as a man. I love you.
Not just literally, but, you know, figuratively as well.
I don't sexually love you. I love you as a brother, fraternally. How does that sound?
That's even scarier.
Now, let's get to the news. 1 minute, I'll be off your other calls. Allergen news. Within this week, or first week of February, Allergen's having its fourth quarter conference calls where they'll be announcing phase two big clinical results of vonoprazan new product. The rumor is it works. It's not a cure. It's 10 times more effective than Rogaine minoxidil. It'll give you significant amounts of hair. Will it be a cure? No. Fair enough?
That's your news. That's what people wanted to hear. People in the chat room are telling us to move along. They want to hear your news, and that was it.
This is the only news I have. Unless someone hates some bullshit. It's the only news I got. I deal in the facts, Spencer. Only the facts.
Well, I'm glad.
As a retired police officer, I deal in the facts and only facts. And Spencer, I apologize to you for the last thing. It was a poor joke on my part. I should have notified your staff ahead of time. It was only a joke.
Okay, Joe. Well, it's not a problem. You are forgiven.
Forgive me, man.
Joe. You're forgiven.
All I gotta say is, consider the height you mentioned.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Translate that for your non-Jewish audience, please.
You translate it because I gotta go. I gotta take a piss.
I think it means good luck. You're a good friend. Am I correct?
Well. Yeah, I mean it's good luck in that you're a good person.
You're a great human being, something like that.
That's what it means. All right, man.
Thank you again, Spencer. Good night, Joe.
Good night, Joe. Wish
you luck. Call Alan to wish me luck.
Don't worry. You don't need any luck, all right?
Tell him not to shave my head. I got nervous.
Dude, don't this is what I'm going to tell you. Don't jump into anything. Don't jump into surgery.
Greatest surgeon in the world.
Don't jump into anything, dude. Still surgery. You could still be fucked up by anybody.
Even Alan?
Oh, my God. How long have you been listening to this show?
18 years.
Okay. I recommend doctors who are doing some of the best, most consistent work out there. But there isn't a doctor out there that hasn't fucked somebody up. It's not their fault, necessarily. It's just the way that it is.
Shit happens.
It's cosmetic surgery, dude.
Right. One final thing, 30 seconds. You ever met Alan in person, Spencer?
Do I what?
Have you met Alan in person?
I have, yes, several times.
Is he handsome in person as he is on the internet?
He's even more handsome in person than he is on the internet.
How tall is he about you? So I know to recognize him. I'll be waiting for him.
I don't know. 5'10", 5'9", something like that, average height.
Okay. So I'm sure Alan will be contacting you after our meeting.
Okay, man. Good luck.
Thank you, man. Thank you, Spencer, for hooking me up. Of course, you make me the star I am today. I wouldn't be getting this consultation.
All right.
But thank you, Spencer.
All right, you got it.
You're real good,
man. Can you let me go? Please let me go.
Yeah.
I got to go.
Good night.
Okay.
Good night,
bye.
Joe.
Jesus Christ. It's exhausting, man.
God bless him.
Doesn't end.
I'm happy for the guy. He's actually pulling the trigger or something.
Well, I'm glad he's moving forward. But,
yeah,
you know, I don't know. I mean, all of a sudden he wants a laser cap, and now he's thinking about getting more transplants. And
hey, he's motivated.
Yeah.
Something happened that motivated him, and I think it's a good thing because
he's not wallowing in his misery.
Thank you.
Well, you know, but this is what scares me about the situation. What happens if things don't work out to his liking? Because he's extremely critical. Then he's going to go into a deeper depression. I wish he was able to figure out a way to live with things as they are. at his age. He's like 56 years old. Now, I think it's great if he can be repaired, and I think that he can be, from what I understand. I think it's great that, you know, Alan is willing to work with him. But, you know, even if he does a stellar job, what happens if that doesn't meet Joe's expectations?
That's a great question, and it comes down to God help him.
Yeah.
As far as I'm concerned, I mean, I'm sure he'll do a fine job, but like you said, you know, Joe has expectations that may not be realistic. He has standards that may not be realistic.
That's what I'm thinking, and that's my concern.
And no doctor will be able to meet them. So yeah, I think it's a valid concern.
Yeah. Well, listen, we'll see. And who knows? Alan could, Dr. Bauman can see him and say, "Look, I don't want to work on this guy."
Yeah.
Possible. He may just like open the door, see him, and throw the laser cap in, and then run. That's a possibility.
An Alan Bauman shaped hole in the wall.
All you're gonna see is a silhouette.
You know, like on the old Looney Tunes.
Yeah.
Right? Bam.
Gonna get the hell out of there. Let me tell you something. As soon as Joe opens that door with the fanny pack and the white baseball cap, it's very possible. And I really think, Dr. Bauman, if you're listening, you gotta bring a witness. That's all I'm saying.
I just like to be a fly on the wall. That's all I'm saying.
Oh my God, Jesus! You know what? Instead of taking a break, I think I'm gonna end the show early. So because we didn't take any breaks, I'm just gonna go. How do you feel about that?
Hey, you know what? I'm feeling good. Okay. It was a good show.
Very busy guys. I'm sorry. I'm gonna hang up on the couple of callers that were holding on. Sorry about that, but I kind of feel like you know, I gotta take a piss. I want to get some food.
No, nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
Empty out and refill.
Yeah. But Joe Tillman, thank you so much. It was a great show. I had a lot of good calls, a lot of good questions. I'm glad that you were on the air when this kid Chris called in, because I know that you actually helped him out originally. Yeah. You hooked us up, and I was able to help him get his refund from this clinic, who I'm not even going to mention, because this woman, after I, you know, said, listen, you know, you got to help this guy out, she went nuts on me.
Really?
Oh my God! Just did
interesting.
Did some stuff that
I don't. I don't think I recall that part of the story.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's just all I did was say, "Listen, this guy's, you know, he's calling the show. He needs your help. He, you know, it's a small amount of money. Just give the guy a refund." I was very nice about it.
Yeah.
And. This industry is so screwed up.
Which is why I'm kind of glad about, well, we can talk about it another time, but it's something I'm kind of glad to be away from right now.
You know what? You want to talk about it? Hold on for a second. Let me take a quick break.
All right. That's cool.
All right, guys, we're going to take a quick break. I just got to take a piss. 888-659-3727. I'm Spencer Kobren. You're listening to and watching The Bald Truth. Stay with us.
To make hair loss history.
They wish to cure us, but I say we are the cure.
It's Spencer David Kobren.
Hey guys, welcome back. Thanks for letting me take that break. 888-659-3727. I know that the guys from Queens Network has another show coming on in like, I don't know, I forgot what time, but so I can't stay on the air too much longer. But I can definitely hang out for a little bit if you want to give us a call, 888-659-3727. I apologize for hanging up on those couple of callers who were holding on. I thought I was going to go, but it seems like Joe wants to talk a little bit more. So let's talk. What's happening, Joe?
You got pulled back in.
I always do. I figured, you know what? Let me just. I switched to wine, by the way.
I was going to say, I see this on camera. I see it looks like you're double fisting it here.
Well, you know, I finished my Budweiser. And I'm not going to get into the reason why I cannot get away from Budweiser. I don't care where I live, how sophisticated I'm supposed to be. You know, I drink Budweiser, and that's it. That's the beer that I like.
It looks good in the photos of your view.
Oh, yeah.
I see sometimes.
Oh, yeah.
Little Budweiser in the foreground there.
Yeah, absolutely, man.
It kind of puts perspective into it.
You know what? It does. And you know what? I don't care. I'm telling you, I go out. I go to, like, these functions. And I'll order a Budweiser at you know, when people have like these bars in their home parties, They don't have Budweiser.
Yeah. You got Stella Artois.
Yeah, it's like, how can you? We're in America. Now, I know that Budweiser is not being made in St. Louis anymore, but I mean, we're in America, for crying out loud. Why can't I just get a Budweiser?
But when you drink a Budweiser, aren't you now drinking a Danish beer?
Yes, you are. You are. Yeah. It's no longer, it's the same formula. But still, you know what? I mean, I'm going to bring it back to the States. You know what? Maybe I'll contact Anheuser-Busch and see if we can do something with the sufferers. Get sufferers, because you know what? They're losing their brand.
Yeah. The microbrew movement started 15, 20 years ago.
Yeah, let's get sufferers drinking Budweiser. 2/3 of men by the age of 35. Instead of trying to just appeal to, you know, these, who are they trying to appeal to now? They're trying to appeal to more women. They're trying to appeal to, I'm trying to think of their commercials. Let's appeal to the sufferers.
I like that. But what if someone kind of correlates hair loss and Budweiser? Then they're screwed.
You know what? They're already screwed. So let's give it a shot. Let's see what happens. You know, they could say, all right, 10% of all Buds being sold are going to be, it's going to go to hair, directly to hair loss research.
See, I can get behind that. I like that.
And every sufferer is going to start drinking. I mean, even if they're just starting, they're going to start drinking Buds.
Their stock will go through the roof.
Right, I'm gonna make that call tomorrow. All right, so go ahead, man. So what's going on? What's going on with you?
Well, you know, a little bit of this, a little bit of that. I just wanted to kind of address something. I've been getting an unusual amount of emails and a couple of questions online about what I'm doing, where I'm working, who I'm working for, whom I'm working with, and what's taking up my time. The answer is I'm not working for anyone, including, as everyone knows, Hasna Wong, and now including Dr. Rahal. I'm no longer with the Rahal Clinic, and this has been the case for a little while now.
You're kind of unofficially working with the Bald Truth, though.
Unofficially working with the Bald Truth, yeah. But it's... You know, people have been asking me behind the scenes, and I've been saying, well, yes, I am still working with Dr. Rahal because I've been working on a project that recently ended, but I have not been working for Dr. Rahal as a consultant online.
You know that I have been asked the question many times, and I'm just like, and even on the show, I'm like, I don't know what the hell is going on because I don't want to ask you. It's none of it's any of my business.
No, it's okay. You know, you could have asked. I wish you knew that you could have come to me. If you're curious about something that's going on in my life, I'd be flattered that you'd want to know.
You know, honestly, as far as your professional life is concerned, I don't give a shit. Your personal life, that's different. But you know what? This industry is so insane that I don't want to even delve into anybody's, you know, work life. Well, I don't want to know.
And here's the thing, you know, my departure. My separation from the Rahal Clinic has nothing to do with the quality of the work. I want to make that perfectly clear. He's an outstanding surgeon. He's got outstanding... One thing I really like about Dr. Rahal's clinic is the post-op follow-up, the post-op care, I should say.
Yeah.
They have a system in place that really puts the patient up front to where they feel like they're being taken care of. Or at least that's the impression I got, because they're always contacting the patients at specific intervals to make sure their progress is coming along, make sure they don't have any questions or any concerns. And I really like that about them. And of course, like I said, the work is outstanding. So, you know...
I got to tell you, Dr. Rahal's got some really good hair himself.
He does.
You know, he's got a nice head of hair, that guy.
And it's, some of the surgeons out there have some great hair. It makes you wonder how they get into this. But regardless, I'm no longer with the organization. And what I'm doing now, I've got a business I'm starting with a friend of mine, a partner of mine. But I'm taking my hair transplant experience and my knowledge to, you know, back into my own website, hairtransplantmentor.com. It's still in a temporary reconstruction status. It's just a kind of like a skeleton site right now, where I'm putting up some articles here and there, some blog posts. But I have a new site that's being built that's going to have a lot of patient-centric offerings and a focus that is going to be, I think, I hope, unique in the industry where I'm going to have some things that haven't been seen before. So I'm really taking, it's interesting, or at least to me anyway, I'm taking what I've learned as a patient, a repair patient, a success patient, and an industry insider, and I'm applying it to be, I'm applying my experience to be more of a benefit to the patient than I think it has been in the past. And
well, you know, you were limited before, and this is what I think is important. The reason why I have you on this program, the reason why I've had you, you've been a friend of the Bald Truth for so many years, is because as much as I know, as deep in the trenches as I have been, and as much as I know about what happens behind the scenes in this industry, I have A, never had a hair transplant, and B, I have never worked day in and day out in a hair transplant clinic. So you were always able to bring a unique perspective to the broadcast, a perspective that I just, you know, I know what I know. I know what I know across the board in ways that, you know, unless you're in my position, you can never know. But what you know is what it feels like to be cut. You know what it feels like to deal with the emotional roller coaster of having a bad hair transplant, then getting repaired, and then waiting for the repair work to come in, and having surgery after surgery. You also know what it's like to sit there and, you know, deal with happy patients, unhappy patients. And I'm not just talking about through a computer screen or on a telephone, but in person coming into your office, you having to look at their scalps and them saying to you, wait a second, I'm not feeling right about this. And you having to deal with all, those are all, you know, that's a unique perspective that I just don't have. And that's why I like having you on the program. And I think that's something that you could offer as an independent that you might not have been able to offer, you know, consumers and patients when you were working for a specific clinic.
And thank you. And you know, the way I look at the industry and what the direction I'm taking, you know, I'm not going to be working for any particular clinic. And I honestly, I don't want to work for any one clinic in the future, because I think that for me to work for a single clinic would mean me saying, hey, this is the best clinic that I think anyone should go to, which there is no best clinic. There is no single doctor. There is no single clinic that is a be-all, end-all for every patient out there. And especially with the I guess you could say the new crop of practitioners coming into the field that, in my opinion, are doing solid work.
Oh, yeah.
Are changing things for the better, as far as I'm concerned.
You know what's funny, though? There's people online that don't think that's the case. And there's a couple of very, you know, staunch online users who believe that the innovations that are coming down the pike are merely innovations that are going to be implemented so the doctors can make a better living.
Go ahead. Yeah, I was going to say, I want to address that. Change is coming. Change is here, as far as I'm concerned. And
oh, shit. Even the doctors don't know what's happening this year. 2015 is the year of the hair transplant. And what's happening now is just, it's mind-boggling. And
things are moving so fast that I think that a strong, healthy proportion of the old guard are going to be absolutely blown away and left in the dust. And in 5 years, no one will even remember who they are.
It's funny that you say that, because, you know, I know exactly what's happening and I see it. And, you know, these guys, they're trying to hold on to the field so tight that they're not opening their eyes up enough to see how much these changes are going to benefit patients and in the long run the field. You know, these changes are going to benefit people's lives. So
the future belongs to people that can see, that have foresight about what's happening.
Right.
And what you said is absolutely true. And the way I look at the industry now, you know, a clinic that wants to work with me would have some balls, as far as I'm concerned, because the way I'm going to be talking about the surgeries and options and things that are available, not to mention the standards that patients should be demanding and the information that they should know when they go into a transplant, you know, a lot of people aren't going to like it.
And let me tell you
something. It's going to stir some feathers.
You know, when I started the IHRS, when I started doing what I was doing, when I originally had the Bald Truth list and the first recommended list ever as published, you know, by a major publisher, I told him, I'm not going to sell surgery. If you're connected to me, you have to understand that whoever contacts me is going to be, my first instinct is to talk them out of having surgery. So you have to be brave enough to be able to be a part of what we're doing and to understand that this is how I do things. I'm not selling anything. If you're with me and, you know, people see that you're connected to what I do because I find you to be, you know, a real expert in the field, great. But if someone contacts me and says, should I have surgery with so-and-so, I'm going to say you should really reconsider surgery and make sure that you know it's a last resort.
Yeah.
And all these guys were like, okay, because they were ethical guys. Now, you know, a lot of these guys also attach themselves to other resources that are out there where, you know, they feel there's a pure marketing aspect to it, which is fine, too. Listen, they have to make a living.
Of course.
I understand that. I cannot fault them for that. But, you know, I don't see why anybody wouldn't want to connect themselves to the message that you're going to present, because it's very similar to mine.
Yeah, well, I was going to say, it's similar to yours. You know, you laid the groundwork for what I consider to be the, you could almost call it, guerrilla consumer advocacy, right?
And you know what? I take that as a compliment. Thank you.
Feel free to use that, by the way.
I will. I just TM'd it.
And but yeah, you laid the groundwork for that. And, you know, working with you over the past several years is, you know, there's been some influence there for sure, coupled with, you know, things I've seen in the industry on all kinds of levels that just kind of left me thinking there's a better way. And so, you know, will I work with clinics in the future? Well, it depends on if clinics are willing to step up and, you know, kind of up their game on the way that they're willing to interact with patients and the level of transparency that they're willing to deal with, which is what we were talking about before.
Right.
Because you and I think along the same lines that the more transparent you are, the more reward you'll get in the long term, because people will recognize your ethics. I think it's to the point now where you can't look at a clinic and say, oh, or a small group of clinics, like say three or four, and say these are the best guys in the world, because you honestly don't know.
There's so many guys
out there right now to where, you know, they're doing really good, solid work. It's no longer a matter of who does the best work. It's who's the most ethical and transparent while doing this good work.
You know, and there's different levels of transparency. You know, the one thing that I've always tried to do in my career was, you know, when I created the IHRS, I wanted the public to know that these guys paid an annual or monthly screening fee.
And I
wanted them to know exactly how much it was. It didn't bother me that people were counting my money. Now, you know, at certain times it did backfire as far as, you know, some, you know, unhappy doctors going out there and making all kinds of insane claims. And no one likes to see someone becoming, you know, successful or wealthy or whatever it is, you know, if they're not allowed to be included in that. But to me, providing that full disclosure always made me bulletproof. And that is an important aspect that I try to tell these doctors they need to do as well.
And that's, I think, probably some of the best advice you could give a clinic. And that's the way that I'm now able to conduct myself, because I'm not representing anyone that's paying my bills.
Yeah, but here's the good news. Whoever you worked with in the past has been great.
So you've
always worked with great clinics.
Absolutely. I wouldn't work with clinics that weren't great. It's just, you know, I've always been the kind of person where, you know, I've always been in sales. And this is kind of common sense, but I can't sell something that I don't believe in. Right. I mean, I have to believe in it wholeheartedly. And in other words, I would do the same thing myself.
Right.
And if I wouldn't do it, then why would I?
And you did it five times or seven times or how many?
Seven.
Yeah.
five times with Dr. Wong. But So
who's he's a great guy, by the way. You know what I like about Jerry is that he's very modest.
Yeah.
He's really, in my view, helped to change the industry in a way that most people don't recognize, at least publicly.
Yeah.
And he doesn't even talk about it.
He doesn't. He just, you know, the thing about Jerry is he just likes to do the work.
Yeah.
You know, and I got to say, he was really, you know, when I left the clinic, he was really gracious. And one of the things that he was concerned about was if I was moving, if I was leaving the area. And when I told him I wasn't, he said, well, I'm glad because I like going to your wife's concerts.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah. It was just it was a little joke between
another
us,
hair transplant nice. Surgeon with an incredible head of hair.
Yeah, oh my God. One of the best on the planet. I mean,
I've never seen anything like, and it's like a beautiful salt and pepper, like but like a teenage hairline.
Yeah. Yeah, and thick, and the hair is coarse, and it's dense, and people would always come in and say, I want a result like you have, and he'd just kind of laugh and say, maybe not. It's sometimes it's too much.
It's majestic. It really is.
It is.
Now,
it is.
We have a couple of minutes. We have a call on the line. Mm-hmm. We can take a phone call if you want. I don't know if someone wants to ask you a question, but let's see who this is. Hey, man, you're on the air. Who's this, and where are you calling from?
Hi, guys. This is Dave Artista.
Oh, my God. Hey, Dave Artista. How are you, man?
I'm fine. How are you, too?
We're good. So did you hear Joe from Staten Island again denying everything?
Yes, I did. I'm here in my art studio, and I was listening to the show, and I heard him call in, and he said the things that he said, which makes no sense at all.
Well, I'm seeing the beginnings of a cat fight. Yeah.
It's good radio. So let's hear what you have to say.
Well, he had told me to call in and tell you exactly what I had said to you, that he was officially
resigning
from your show,
and the reasons and why, and the fact that he wanted to work with the Real Hair Loss Show. You read that on the air.
Exactly, and I verified that with him before I would do this. So prior to calling you, I had verified that this is exactly what he wanted me to do.
Now, was this an email that he sent to you and said, read this online, or was this transcribed by hand over the phone?
No, he sent him an email, I think.
No, it was via email. And I think we may have spoke on the phone about it, but it was basically email, and it was verified. And I couldn't understand it. He said nothing about having health issues. He said nothing about having to go to be, taken care of by a doctor. He just told me that he was done with your show, and that was it.
I also think that he was a little jealous that I was having Joe Tillman on more often.
I think so too. I'm not sure, but I think so. Joe Tillman's a great guy. I mean, he really adds to the show. You do, Joe.
I wouldn't have him on if he didn't.
I appreciate that.
The only reason he wasn't on more often before is because he was busy doing his own thing. But, anytime, over the years, you were actually on the show when I was on the radio, years ago, right, Jeff?
God, yeah, that was, how long ago was that? Oh.
Well, I got off the air in 2009, but I was on the radio for over a decade. So.
Yeah, I was on several times. This is, when you're on XM and then Westwood One.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I always enjoyed having Joe on because Joe is a real expert as far as, surgical hair restoration. He's in the trenches. He's a real patient, and he's a very unique voice for the show. And I think now that I've been having him on more often because he's had more time and he's decided that, this is kind of a direction that he wants to go in, I kind of think Joe's getting a little jealous. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know.
Maybe, maybe not. But I think it's a great idea to have Joe Tillman on with you.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate that.
There you go.
And he did say a couple nasty things about me in the email as well. I don't remember exactly what they were, but I believe he called me out on a couple of things.
Well, I remember Dave reading that. And I didn't want to bring that up, but yes, Dave read some not so nice things about you. And, look, it is what it is. But Joe, just so just like you, I'm not paying Joe Tillman. Joe Tillman is doing this. He's giving his time. He wants to help people out. And he likes being attached to the show. And that's it. That's just the way that it works. That's how we do here at The Bald Truth.
And the chicks love it.
The chicks dig it.
You're both very objective, and that's the way to be when it comes to this sort of thing.
Well, it is. And Joe's also, you are what? You're probably about 5 or 6 years younger than I am, Joe, right? How old are you?
I'm 45.
Okay. So I'm 49. So, we're close in age, but we're not that close in age. I mean, that's kind of, when you're growing up, that's a big difference. But as an adult, when you're an adult, it's really not much of a difference. But you've lived a very a very interesting life as far as being in the world of hair loss, dealing with the hair loss the way that you had to deal with it, dealing with surgery the way that you had to deal with it, and then being in the industry. I mean, and you were, when you talk about being a major player, I mean, you are truly, and this is, some people may not like me saying this, but you're really the original hair transplant mentor. You're the guy that went online and documented his case in a way that no one had ever done before. And now everyone's doing that.
Everyone's doing
and
it.
And you have a great website, too. Yeah, great website.
So that's why I think, you know, because, you know, listen, the bald truth is OG. This, we are the original gangster. So why not have the original gangster hair transplant mentor as part of the show?
Yes.
it has been a hell of a ride. I got to tell you, I mean, you know, when I first drove up from Seattle to have this first procedure with this Chinese name sounding doctor I'd never met, for my repair, I never dreamed that my result would be, you know, from the first procedure would be so good, where my life would be turned around. It was like a weight lift off my shoulder, like I can't describe. I mean, to this day, I still remember the elation of walking out of the clinic that first day. I'll never forget. It was March 18, 2002. There was a blizzard in Vancouver, and I had to drive back to Seattle. It's normally a three-hour drive. It was a six-and-a-half-hour drive through the snow. And
wow.
But I didn't care. I was so happy because I knew that my transformation was underway. And even then, I had, you know, no idea what the result would be like. I just knew it would be a hell of a lot better. But to even suggest, to hint at what my future had in front of me for the next 15 years or 14 years, no way would I think
the
this.
Fact that you were able to drink in my house
and that's out. Just a bonus. And that's just a bonus. I mean,
but guys, listen, this is, I'm having a great time tonight, but Andrew just contacted me. He's got another show coming up in about 10 minutes.
Yeah.
So I have to get off the air.
Can I bring up one more thing?
Sure.
Can I bring up one more thing?
Yeah.
If Joe Tillman could talk about Bobman real quick, Bobman's transformation was fantastic. You know, he and I are close friends, and
well, he was a poster boy for hair transplantation and Hassan Wong.
Absolutely, I was kind of like a poster boy for repair work.
Yeah,
and he's a poster boy for non-repair work. You know what you can do with big sessions. You know, two sessions on a Norwood 6, and you're done. And he's Well, three actually, but the third one's a very small minor touch-up. But the two main procedures, I mean, completely transformed him. Completely transformed. Took 15 years off his life. Off his look, sorry, not his life.
That's not good, yeah.
Didn't push him to the grave. No, just made him look 15 years younger. And you know, he's one of the all-time greats, for sure.
And to see it up close, in person, you know, and he would show me his full scalp, and you know, he's very open about it.
Of course,
it looked great.
Oh, I mean, open he about it. His picture is everywhere, even on like Indian hair transplant websites that haven't done the surgery on him.
He was on a billboard in Beirut.
That is awesome. That is so fucking funny.
I think it was him. He was on a post. Billboard on the side of a highway in Beirut.
Well, listen, guys, I'm getting the high sign. I got to do a hard break now. We got to go. Artista, thank you so much. You know what? Call in next week. Let's talk more about your experience and, you know, and about what Joe from Staten Island really said to you.
Yes, I will.
Because it looks like he's turning on you now, dude.
Yeah,
he's getting ugly.
I don't
getting
understand ugly. It. I'm trying to be friendly with him and help. I tried to help him, and now he's slamming me.
I'm just starting shit, guys. Listen, Artista, thanks a lot. We'll talk soon. All right. Take care.
All right, guys.
All right.
Good night, Artista.
Right. Bye-bye.
Joe Tillman, man, thank you so much. I guess maybe we'll have you on next week. We'll see what happens if you're free.
We'll see. All right.
All right, man.
Fun. Have a great night.
All right, man. Thanks a lot. Guys, let me give out the websites, thebaldtruth.com for archived broadcasts of this show. If you want to check out information on hair loss, check out AmericanHairLoss.org. And also, you can obviously go to our message forum, which is baldtruthtalk.com. I want to give a special shout out, and I hate using shout out, to the Tom Leica Show for their success this year. They made a profit this year, and that was their goal. As internet broadcasters, and I certainly understand how difficult it is to be successful in what we do. And Tom has been a long time, very powerful terrestrial radio figure and personality. And he decided to go out there as an entrepreneur and do his own thing online. And he is doing really well. I'm a fan of the show. His associate producer, Dino, used to work for me. And we are still friends, and I'm very proud of those guys, and I'm glad that they've had so much success. Believe me, guys, I know what it takes, and very few of us can make that happen. So congratulations. Until next time, be strong, God bless, and thank you so much for listening. Take care.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry for any inconvenience you may have been put to prior to the program, and I'm glad you enjoyed it. And if you could now leave by the exits at the rear, that'd be splendid. Thank you. Good night.